This should be episode 60 of Summoning Insight. And this episode is going to be mainly focused, not around league games, they're not going on. In fact, actually, as a general principle, Monty, I haven't particularly talked to you about this much, but for going forwards, because I want us, when we can, when schedules allow, time permits, to do regular episodes every week if we can, I actually think sometimes in the past, just because we got into the rhythm and the routine of doing it, we got new guests on it, and there was a formula to follow, I think sometimes maybe we did go a bit too much on the rails of doing actual games each week, you know. Like, sometimes maybe we talked about a team where we'd already talked about in the last 3 weeks and not much had changed, you know. So even though I want us, I do, one of the basic concepts of the show when we formed it was that there would be a regular show where people who came on the show would watch all the big games and they'd comment on them, because the community didn't have that at the time. I think also we should also court more of the like salon type aspect, where you just get people on and whatever their expertise is, you talk a bit more about that. So for example, an episode that really made me think about this was the one where we last had LS on, because famously, through a bit of miscommunication and just me forgetting, I forgot that he actually did say he hadn't watched any League of Legends within 2 months. And so he mainly wanted to come up with the initial discussion that was about coaching. And obviously on that topic, he's got a lot of interesting ideas. He's got a unique perspective and voice and some experience that we don't have, for example. So that was an interesting discussion. The problem is, then when we went onto the part that was just about the games, obviously it wasn't as fitting there. So we probably should have done an episode with him that was 80% about that. And then the 20% would be just me and you talking about the games. So in general, that's what we're going to do. So for this episode, there's obviously no games. It's just this topic. And the topic is going to be about the top 20 players at Worlds. And it's spurred by this article, well, an article series, actually, by lolesports. So the journalistic arm of Riot Games. And they've got the top 20 and they're revealing them like one at a time. And they've revealed six so far. They've revealed spots 20 to 15. And they're up there on their sites. And they're written by different people. So if you want to go and read them, I'd suggest going and read them. They're interesting. You'll be surprised by some of the reasoning given and the places. Now, here's the thing, Monty, the actual premise of doing this. People might think, I know you probably saw this on Twitter, Monty, as soon as these things happen, as soon as the list's even announced and the first names get announced, people start like pestering us, like, I bet you guys can't wait to do a piece about this. Like, oh my God, someone must reply to this. You have to realize, I think of LoL Esports a lot differently to a lot of the fans out there. You know, I don't get as mad, actually, Monty. I know you get a bit riled up sometimes, but here's the thing. I'll give you an analogy to explain how I think of LoL Esports by giving you an analogy about my favorite team, TSM, a team I think about a lot, Monty. So I always say to people, so you know this big thing's going to come out where people really think that, some people naively think that when Dyrus said that he's going to kind of like expose people after Worlds when he retires, some people actually thought, oh wow, he's going to like drop dime on Reggie and all the things that he's done to him and, you know, his disappointments. And I said, no, that seems very unlikely, you know, that seems entirely unreasonable. Because I said, the analogy you have to understand is, every time we watch like video of Reggie, you know, like going in on Dyrus, criticizing him in a way where he's literally just telling him, like, you know, you failed in this way, you are failing this way, you must do things, you know, no uncertain terms, you're not in any discussion in some of these areas. I look at it, and it's true, I get caught up in it. I start thinking, like, wow, that's so abusive. Like, how could you be in a relationship with someone like that and respect yourself and respect them as a person for treating you that way? But what I didn't realize, and this is what's turned the corner for me, Monty, is you just have to get the what's going on behind the scenes and the external concepts of their relationship and apply it as sort of like visual metaphors within the conversation. Okay, so when Reggie's talking to him and he's like, Dyrus, you failed in that game again, you were explicitly told, imagine as he's saying that, he leans over and he puts a 1,000 bundle of dollar bills into Dyrus's back pocket. He goes, you failed again. He looks him in the eyes and he goes, I told you before to work on these champions. You bought the wrong boots. As he says that, he pops another stack into his right pocket, taps that as he does so. And then he goes, the coaches told you, Loco Doco's asked you again and again, you've got to ask for Gank's top. You can't just blame Santorin and rage out at him. Another stack in his left top corner pocket. As he's doing that, if someone was doing that to you, even if on the surface it would seem really abusive, etc., first of all, you'd get used to that. And secondly, you'd have this like positive association with every time they're abusing, because you'd be like, I mean, I'm getting richer, the stack's going in my pockets. Later on, you know, probably later on when he goes to take his coat off, he touches a stack and goes, oh yeah, that's right, Reggie was giving me advice before, and he has the $1,000 bill up there. So the point I'm making here, okay, Monty, it's going to seem convoluted, right? You're like, how could he possibly get this to LoL Esports? What I love about LoL Esports is every time LoL Esports writes a piece like this or attempts to tackle a difficult topic like this, what Thorin thinks is like, oh great, $100 for Thorin. And so it's almost just like I'm following around a really clumsy, well-meaning idiot, and every time he tries to like cross the road or something, he actually accidentally throws away, thinking he's throwing away an old wrapper, like $1,000 on the floor. I'm like, oh, okay, I'll pick that up. Yep, that's for me. And then all I have to do is keep following him. If I just keep following him, I'm going to get my nice little stack of money at the end. Okay, so that's the metaphor, Monty. So you understand the premise now. I'm looking forward to this, to enjoying this.
And speaking of money, what about Alpha Draft, Thorin?
Yes, what about them, sir? So Alpha Draft is our people who sponsor fantasy esports, such as this sort of a list, which is absolutely ludicrous and doesn't make any sense. Hey, maybe they used the Alpha Draft rankings. Maybe they used regional rankings. So they got like Ziv within only LMS, and they got Doublelift only within NA. And so when they compared the numbers directly without context, because we all know context doesn't mean a whole lot, you know, he did have better numbers, you know. So maybe that's what they did. I don't know. Maybe after secretly involved. I don't know. All I know, fantastic website that pay some of the best people in the industry, at least two. I can promise a minimum of two. They pay them and they offer a service where you can play fantasy esports, such as World Championships. And you can do each of the days of the groups. And first of all, there's a contest that you can win like $5,000 or something in five stacks. That's like Reggie telling you five bad things about yourself. Think of it that way, guys. That's the value system we're going with here. Or you can think of it as they've got all different tiers of competitions. I always give the analogy that it reminds me of when I first went on poker sites. And yeah, poker has the cash game where you pay and you pay per hand, etc., with the stack you've got. But you can also enter a tournament. And the idea of the tournament was, the genius of the poker site was not just to have normal tournaments, like a $20 tournament with 20 people in. They basically did it so you could pick almost any range you wanted. You could have one with two people in, you could have one with 50 people in, you could have one with 1,000 people in. So the idea was, you had two questions. How much do you want to pay so that you have that? And then how much do you want to win? And it really is like that. So, okay, do you want to win 1,000 for only $10? Well, there's going to be loads of people in the tournament, then it's going to be pretty hard. Do you want to win, put $10 in and maybe win $50? Right, there's going to be less people in it. You just have to beat them. So it's up to you what level you want to pay at. So it's a similar concept around Alpha Draft. Go to the link in the box below if Thorin is remembered. So now that that's out of the way, Monty, on to the top 20. So to give us the prelude. What are your basic thoughts as we go into this? What was your initial reaction to the top 20 from lolesports?
Incredulity. I think that just taking a look at the players, we've only seen, what, six players so far, 15 through 20, but having Aframu, who has legitimately, in the context of NA, had a good season, above a player like Peekaboo is interesting to me. And it's not only that, but I would actually, you know, on my ranking, which we're going to go through here, I have Peekaboo rated in the bottom five, personally. But okay, we have to consider against Aframu that Gorilla, Yellowstar, Peekaboo, PYL, and Mako are all in this tournament. And with only 20 players, you have to average four per position. And then you also have to consider the context of a top 20 players. So the question is, like, I guess for me coming into this, I mean, you and I, Thorin, we haven't talked about our criteria, but we're gonna have to agree.
We haven't even compared lists yet.
Yeah, we're gonna have to agree on the criteria.
Yeah.
I think the criteria should be for the top 20 players at Worlds should be the impact that they will make on the game as an individual player.
Okay. I have a similar criteria. Here's my question though. What was that first thing you said where you have to average four players' position? Why do you have to have four there?
You don't have to have four. You don't. Okay. I'm just saying, because there are 20 players, five positions, yeah, average of four, right? Some positions, like, for example, jungles, very weak at this tournament, so we're going to have fewer junglers in the top 20.
Okay, I think we're on similar lines then, Monty, because essentially I've already checked my spots. And for example, jungles, I've got the one I've got the least for. Meanwhile, I've got tons of top laners.
Yeah,
top laners are super sick at the moment. So
you're right. And it's not only just about, when we say top 20 players, like, they may not, because it's not a good meta for a particular position, and it is another position, and it is a very good meta for top laners, we kind of have to weight that a little bit higher, because these are going to be, we say top 20 players, we have to say top 20 performers, i.e. they will have the biggest impact on the games in which they play. So that's my criteria. If I went by like raw skill or like thinking about different metas that exist, it may be a little bit different, obviously. But that's kind of the thought that I have coming in.
Okay, so here's the thing. When we're defining criteria, one criteria I used, and I actually have a bit of a jump on everyone in this sense, because since I've already done top 20 lists for players and teams of all time anyway, I've already basically thought through what my criteria is anyway. And so Yeah, I do consider context within your region and all the rest of it, etc. But I also do try to do the greater sense if I try to compare across regions. With that said, one of the areas that immediately is criteria I have to clarify is you could be a fantastic player, but essentially I don't give you points if the being a fantastic player doesn't actually show up in the game or impact on the team. So the perfect example for this, which we'll get to as we discuss it, is I'll tell you outright, Monty, in my top 20 players, Pawn didn't even make the list.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah, if you asked me who the top 5 mid laners in the world are, Pawn would be in my top 5. And if you even asked me who the top most skilled players in the world, maybe he'd be in my top 20 there. But just because of this factor, I don't think he has that much impact on his team winning, and a lot of his skill is essentially, it's a waste, it's still beautiful to see sometimes, doesn't have that big an impact on the game. As a result, I can't really give him the same amount of points as someone where, for example, I think you could make a reasonable debate, I don't know if I'd agree, that Pawn might be a better mid laner than Rookie, but I think Rookie has a way bigger impact on his team, is much more of a focal point, and so I have Rookie on the list, whereas I don't have Pawn. Now again, a second criteria point, and then I want you to address this to whether you have anything similar. So likewise, another factor that goes with it is in general, unless it's really exceptional circumstances, I tend to only have at most about 2 players from each team. Some teams have exceptional ones and they have 3. But for example, I have a really hard time getting a team like LGD or EGG and giving you like 4 players from each team. I think that's just too much. Like even though someone like Mako or someone like... I even have PYL, I know it's one that you've got, because that is one that we mentioned before the show. There's certain players where I have a hard time putting them on a list just because, they might even be top players in their position. But there's so many other players on their team are fantastic and I think have more impact players to the team winning. So I think it's kind of in line with what you said before, but is there a difference there?
No, I think I definitely have some 4 players. But I think 4 is what I max out on a team. It is... We'll talk about that. We can argue about that later. I'm sure both of us will change our mind over the course of this on some issues as we talk about it.
Okay. So to make it easy, we've agreed. We're actually going to do what lolesports unfortunately can't do. I mean, they could have. They just released this list in one go, but they're obviously trying to farm traffic. So they're releasing it slowly, and normally with this, it's when you release it, you start at the bottom. Now, the bottom is the hardest place to start, because once you get down, essentially, your criteria is still there, but the players are more weakly fitting into it, and so you really have to make not just one like value judgment. You might have to make like 20 and then calculate which ones add up, and it does get complicated. That's why actually you'll notice I didn't just dismiss any of the lolesports ones out of hand, like they were just ludicrous even conceptually. I just think some of them, from my understanding of the game, seem quite wrong, in as much as I don't think they argued their own cases very well. That's the key point to make. Even the criteria they'd used, I think sometimes they didn't apply correctly elsewhere. So anyway, what we'll do to avoid that, because we'll have to get to it eventually, is we'll start at number 1 and go down. And the idea is, at the bottom is where we're going to do most of that stuff, but we'll work our way into it, and you'll see the criteria starting to unfold as we go from 1 to 20. So I assume what we're going to do here is initially say who we had at each spot, and then try and figure out, is there a debate to be had between, and that sort of a thing, you know. So question number 1, Monty, I'll let you start. Who is the number 1 player at Worlds Season 5?
Faker.
Okay, that's who I have. I have Faker number 1 there. What would be the case for Faker?
He doesn't actually take that much. First off, statistically, by the eye test, he had a fantastic summer season. He was pretty damn amazing. His champion pool is still huge. He and Someday played the most champions out of any players in Korea. They both had like 12 regular season picks, and Faker was obviously sharing time with Easy Hoon, although to a lesser degree, and Someday was playing every game, so that's even more impressive. The position in Korea that normally takes the largest percentage of team gold is mid lane, and Faker is actually 5th on that list of mid laners in terms of gold percentage taken. But even though he's very middle of the pack when it comes to mid laners, he actually, when it comes to damage percentage, a position that is usually dominated by AD carry, he's behind 3, so he's 4th, so he's still like showing a lot of movement there, and he does a lot for his team overall. He also does play utility picks from time to time, which makes it a little bit interesting. So, I mean, Faker overall, he's just been incredible. We know he can play absolutely at anything. When it was clutch time in the playoffs, he absolutely dominated KT there's just not really a comparison right now. He's a player unlike any other, and it's been that way for the history of League of Legends. But he had a pretty poor spring season and has really bounced back well. I don't know. It's just, I don't even think anybody can argue that Faker's the best player.
Oh, let me ask you one question. That reminds me of one other criteria we should identify. In general, did you count this like best players of the year, or is it best players right now coming into Worlds?
I think a little bit of both. Like, but I think you really have to consider the summer season. So I think mostly my criteria is the summer season and their performance in that summer season. And then, so like some players may have had a good regular season, but not so good playoffs or vice versa. So you have to consider both those factors. But mostly as we go into Worlds, I'm mostly thinking about summer season, playoffs, regionals for each region.
Yeah, I mean, I have a similar sense in as much as, I mean, I mildly consider over the whole year, but obviously stuff that happened in February doesn't really matter when we're talking about top 20 players at Worlds. Because, for example, you could have had an example there where, well, for example, if that was the case, then I'd have had Prey way higher up my list if we can go by the spring as well. Because for most of that, he's balled out of control. So realistically, I've gone mainly for like now or in the recent past, in as much as we haven't seen him play in the last month. So we have to go from summer, really. That's when they were playing. So, okay, here's the thing. I think Faker is a pretty obvious number one to me. For my money, if you're going to say it's not Faker, part of me, listen, I don't doubt that someone really could think so and could have reasons, but it feels kind of like they're starting to figure out reasons to not give it to Faker, if you know what I mean. As in, they're not really saying, I think Imp is the best player. They're really going, well, the reason why I don't think Faker should be number one, and they start from that position. I kind of just feel like that. I feel like they're starting in that way, and they're going almost, there's a part of them is just looking for a logical way to not give it to Faker. Because, by the way, that's the thing about reasoning and logic, is that we're not talking about mathematics here. This isn't literally resolving an equation or something. What you're doing here is you're choosing which criteria you value over others. Now, the problem in that sort of a scenario is, at the risk of sounding like I'm saying people are being dishonest, I think people just aren't thinking it through. And sometimes they have criteria they would say, I go along with this philosophy. But in a case like this, I think sometimes they go, oh, I'm going to choose this other criteria which matches up with what I want, which is someone else to be number one. Whereas I just get a bit worried if they don't then apply that criteria to everyone. Like, if you're consistent, I don't mind. It's when you pick and choose. I don't think you should ever pick and choose. I try never to do that whenever I do these lists. I try to make it consistent the whole way down, even if that actually means later on it gets the things that are unpleasant for me to put on, which you might see towards the end of this list. Okay, so I just wanted to get that out there.
Oh, as for Faker, I was accidentally looking at the wrong stats. So this makes it even more impressive. So Faker, the right stats, I was looking at the playoff stats, which are only three games. For the regular season, in terms of gold percentage, in a larger sample size of games, Faker took, he was actually in 10th place out of mid laners in Korea, and he was, all starting mid laners in the league were above him when it came to how much gold percentage he took on the team, yet how much damage percentage he did, he ended up only behind Mickey and Coco. So he takes a very small amount of resources proportionally and does a hell of a lot more with them than almost any other player.
What's beautiful to me is what I love about Faker, and this is why it actually is something about it cracks me up that there are still people who like don't want to acknowledge that he's the best, etc. It's almost like the case test for credulity, Monty, because in other games there's been players who were the best, but it was marginal, you know, or it was for a specific reason. The good thing about Faker is he has it all. He's got the most flashy plays, he's got the most highlights, he's got the most champion he's dumpsters on, he beats pretty much everyone, he's won both of the splits this year, he's got the most insane record in history, he's got everything.
He's won four seasons now of champions in Korea.
He's got everything, mate. There's literally almost nothing he doesn't have.
He's won All-Stars, like, I don't even know what to say about this guy at this point. He's got everything, exactly.
It's like, that's why I say you have to really get up early in the morning and have that second cup of coffee to start explaining why someone's not why he's not the number one player, basically. That's what I'm saying. Okay, so number two we're gonna go to now, Monty, and I have a feeling this is one we're gonna agree on again. Who's number two for you?
Imp.
Yeah, that's what I have as well. So what's the reason why Imp's number two?
So Imp had, first off, I mean, he's coming into the World Championship really hot, right? He had an extraordinary performance in the LPL playoffs. I think he was the single biggest factor why LGD won those playoffs. He looks very good, very aggressive in lane. Huge variety, I think, in terms of the champions he can play. Damage output, absolutely amazing. and his positioning great, his laning great. He's a very complete AD carry player. And not only that, but he has picks that no one else was really playing, like Twitch, and that other teams I think aren't going to know how to play against. So given LGD, Imp is a huge reason why they were winning. And also, if we look at the playoffs, Godvi, I think, wasn't looking too sharp in the playoffs overall. He was definitely looking worse than he was in the regular season. So Imp was definitely the main carry during their run.
There's also,
and he was good in the season, too.
If you remember, sadly, the way Season 4 Worlds ended, it was so emphatic, the victory, that even though Imp had this great, great performance himself, because of the fact that his counterpart, Uzi in the final, was so obviously on a team where his teammates aren't on the level that Imps were, it meant that it really contrasted and made Uzi look even better. I think in terms of performance, yes, Uzi's performance was better. Imps wasn't too far off, though. He was still very good himself. He just wasn't straight hard carrying because he didn't have to. And that's not to go against the criteria I said before where someone can't show the skill. He was showing it. It's just that he had a much more complete team. And that's why it was a dominant victory, not just a close one or an amazing comeback like some of the ones EDG had, Star and Roll Club had. But my point is, that's the main peak when most people who are Westerners saw him playing was that Worlds. Maybe they didn't watch all the games in OGN, etc. So for them, it's easy to say, right, yeah, but he had Mata. He had the best support player ever with him. He's played as well or better than that this split. And I don't care what you say about PYL. He's not Mata, mate. He's not an all-time level of Mata. So he's done as much without that. And yes, still with a fantastic team, but not as fantastic a team in my book. What do you think?
Sure. I agree. I mean, I think that's pretty clear.
I think those two actually are reasonably easy. I think those, just because of how hot LGD were recently and then Faker's Faker for this year. So I think those two write themselves almost. I think we're already going to start going astray on pick three.
You ready?
You ready? So who's number three, MT?
Someday.
Jesus Christ. Okay. Yeah. Okay, mate. So explain to me why.
Who's yours? No, you don't get to do that.
My number three is God V, mate.
Interesting. Yeah. I would have placed God V higher, but again, I was a little bit. I don't think he was as good in the playoffs as he was in the regular season, so he fell a little bit for me for that reason. Okay. I mean, you could say Someday wasn't that great in the finals too, so I think a similar argument could be made. But remember when I talked about how these were players who, Someday is a player who's a very good top laner and is certainly very much enabled by the way the team plays. So as a counterpoint to Faker, he does get a lot of gold, but he was the MVP of the summer season in Korea. He was a lot of the reason why KT was doing so well. I think he is the best player in top lane when it comes to sense of split pushing, how to apply pressure, how to win with a split push. He is the player, the top laner, that when he starts snowballing, he is nearly impossible to stop, and he can just outright win a game for you. He can play a huge number of carries in the top lane very proficiently, and he has a great laning phase. Can play many different sides of matchups, has very strange pocket picks. Always a threat on Yasuo, always a threat on Riven, and he's just really, really good right now. It's teleport flanking. You have to remember, even when he's team fighting, he's excellent. He played more Maokai than any other champion in the summer season and was still just ripping people open with great teleport flanks and everything else. So he's been a major factor for KT. And KT could, I mean, there's an outside shot. KT doesn't even make it out of groups if Origin upsets them, but I don't think the reason is going to be Someday. And I think on an individual level, sure, he gets a lot of resources, but he does a fuckload with those resources. And the other reason why he gets so many resources is because once he starts to get ahead, he just dominates the opposition and starts solo killing them.
So here's the problem for me with Someday, who I think is a very good player. Like, I have Someday at number 8, Monty.
Interesting.
Oh, yeah. So I've got 7 players ahead of him, mate. But here's the thing. The problem with Someday is, I don't want to put it all on the LCK finals, because you can't do that, and obviously you can't just say one player was the reason. Like, he played okay in the LCK final. The problem is, he got the champions he wanted in those matches, Monty, and it went so badly.
He did, but they didn't expect Marin to play Malphite, I think, and they overprioritized the Fizz pick. And also, that was a big deviation from the way KT normally drafts. So actually, statistically, in KT's drafts, they nearly never first pick top lane. They almost always counterpick top lane.
Well, they were counterpicking for mid in that series, right?
Yeah, more so. So in that series, I think that was a mistake that they of the game plan going in. I don't think they should have first picked the Fizz, and it was very atypical of KT's normal style of draft.
It felt like they did what I think is actually a classic mistake when you're at the highest level. So if you're playing lesser teams, sometimes it makes sense to have your best player take the hit and be like, right, well, you're the best player, so you can play stuff that's less ideal for you in it to cover for a weaker player, okay? I think that KT in that series was so scared of Faker against Nagne. They just wanted Nagne to be safe all the time. And they were like, right, we'll give you the picks all the time. But as a result, yeah, he actually was reasonably safe. He didn't just get ultra outplayed in every game, but he also had no impact, and it kind of fucked Sunday a bunch of times.
He did get fucking rocked in lane in a couple of those games.
Yeah, but the first game was all right.
He was also camped in the Gangplank game, and he still managed to come back and actually make an impact. So you have to consider that too. Like,
true.
The weird thing about KT is that coming into that, they would for top lane on blue side for first pick, they would only first pick a top laner 16% of their games during the regular season. So it was really weird that they would even pick that. Meanwhile, for top lane, they usually overwhelmingly on blue side, they would take it in the third round of the draft. So it's like they spent most of the season trying to counterpick top, and then they just weirdly first pick Fizz. So I don't really know what was going on there, but it didn't work.
So my pick for number three is God V, formerly Wayless. This is one of the ones where, what's funny is in the top 10, a lot of them, I didn't have that many problems picking. I could pick them. I picked the thought of the teams that are really good. I picked out the players that I think are the real carries. But this is one that was really hard because of the fact I've already picked someone from this guy's team at number two. So that in itself is telling you, I'm telling you, he's not even the best player on his team. And I've got him number three in the list in the whole world. The problem is, I don't think it's fair. It's true. LGD has four players who are all very good.
Yeah.
But do not make the mistake of thinking that God V is the pawn of LGD to pawn in Samsung White. It's not that sort of a role whatsoever. The difference is, I actually think it's the opposite way around. In Samsung White, to me, pawn was almost this afterthought wildcard player who, if he contributed some crazy shit, then you're going to totally dominate. And if not, you might win the game anyway. The game's more about jungle support synergy, and then the bot lane in general is the main carry lane. So that's the main way you're going to win the game. The difference is, in LGD, yes, they've got this monster AD carry. The top lane is fantastic. The support's a very good support in the context of China, definitely. But to me, a lot of what actually leads the direction of the team is God V, because he's this guy who will roam and he'll play that style of play. And so as a result, I actually think, in a way, okay, I think Imp's the best player on the team, but I think God V is the one who sets the identity of the team. That's my reasoning, at least. Did you have him in your top 10?
I think he definitely does. Yes, I have him at number 7. Okay. So I definitely think that he had a really good season, and obviously we know him as a player for his Orianna play, and then I think he's going to flourish at Worlds because he can run a lot of his teleport champions. I mean, if he wants to, he can play TP Diana.
Exactly.
He can play Kassadin, but at the same time, you know, it wasn't that he performed really badly in the playoffs. It's just that Imp was so much more of a force, I feel, in their playoff runs in LPL. And sure, part of that was him playing Lulu some games and kind of setting up, but he also can die randomly at times. And sometimes even when he's like has double digit kills on a champion like Kassadin, he can fail to carry the game, which is a little bit interesting.
Here's the thing, though, Monchi.
He sometimes makes very reckless decisions.
He's one of the only players I have on this list who plays in a role which usually is thought of as like tied to another secondary supportive role, so jungler mid, who I think has a terrible player partnering him in that sense. I mean, he's very self-sufficient. He doesn't like get babysat by TBQ and just kept alive, and he doesn't have any of that shit. He's going against monsters. He's going against Rookie and Pawn and these sorts of guys.
Yeah.
Cool on a regular basis. And he's doing well. This guy really knows how to. He has
really
a very
good
IQ. He has a really good in-game IQ, I think.
Well, and to be fair, God V is, in fact, the second top laner after Faker that I have on this list.
Mid laner.
Mid laner. I just rated him lower than you did.
Okay.
But I think he's excellent, but you're right. I think he does, to a certain degree, set the identity of the team. But it's like someday, if you give someday a lead, he just will win the game. Like, that's just how it works on KT. Whereas Godby can get a lead, and I don't feel that he's as good at closing as someday is.
Because the thing is, we'll get to this later, but Godby is one where I myself am tortured on, because it's an example of where, when you're talking about an overall player, regardless of position, how good he is, I do think he's fantastic. But there's a part of me, just my own natural inherent biases, I actually kind of, just as a mid laner, again, this is like the clear love debate, jungler versus overall player, I actually feel like Rookie's a better mid laner. It's just that Godby, you're talking about a player, overall impact on the team and the map, I've got him higher. So that's why I had to go Godby there, even though it's a tough one. So let's go to number four, Monty. Who is number four for you?
Who is number four for me? We have, surprisingly, clear love.
Oh, God. See, I think, see, now it's going to turn, Monty. I'd successfully, you know how I kept doing that? I brought them all on Summon Insight, and I kept deflecting it off me onto you. I was like, no, Monty's, he thinks clear love shit, and he's not even a good jungler. Meanwhile, the whole time, I respect him as a player. I think as an overall player, he's good. He does deserve a place in history, you know, but I'll just tell you right out, Monty. You've got him number four. You ready? I've got clear love. Number 13.
15.
Unlucky,
yeah,
number 13. So, okay. So tell me why clear love's the number four player for you.
So mostly, like you were saying with your reasoning behind Godby being sort of the focal point of the team, I think this year has been very good for clear love. And I think that when I watch EDG and I see their highs and lows, I think that clear love's performance is the best indicator as to how well EDG is going to be doing. And if we also think Def didn't have as good of a season in summer as he did in spring, Paulin, like you said, is very flexible. He's a very fluid player, but he's not going to be the one carrying a lot of these games. I think clear love is the major factor that gets his team rolling, and that his pathing has been very creative and interesting to watch. And he does a whole hell of a lot for EDG. And I don't think EDG is anywhere near as good with a different jungler.
I mean, I agree with a lot of what you say there, Monty. The problem I have with clear love, which still remains to this day, listen, he can get the kill percentage up to 100%, mate. Like he could get it to a full 100%. I'm not sure it would change this. A part of me feels like, okay, just somehow, it's hard to explain this. Okay, so when you talk about ganking or counter ganking, that sort of a jungle style, when Dandy does it, I don't think Dandy does it because he has to do it like that. And we're not talking about Dandy now, by the way. We're talking historically the archetype of what Dandy represents as the ultimate hybrid jungler, okay? He does it because at that moment in the game, it's exactly the right thing to do. If he needs to, as you saw at Season 4 Worlds, he can just go, oh, you know what? I think this game, I'll just play carry jungle against this guy who's on a bad champion. We banned all his shit out, and I'm just going to wreck him solo. He can also do that if he wants. The difference is, I don't think Clear Love can do that. I think Clear Love plays this style, which is great for his team. He's got the exact right team for him again in his career. It's just that's pretty much, it's hard to describe. I guess I guess he does it, but in a way that's not quite as impressive, if that makes sense. I mean,
yeah. And you could argue too that Clear Love didn't have the best playoff performance, right? Even on his Lee Sin, which he had in the spring season, like an incredible KDA on, I think it was like 12 or something like that for all his Lee Sin games. In the match that they went against LGD, he went 2-5-5 on that champion, and he was struggling. And that's true. But I think that when we look at Clear Love over the course of the season and consider that the way Clear Love plays allows Pawn to play champions like Kassadin that require a long time to scale. Like, he's very, very good at feeding Pawn, super good at feeding Pawn, and just standing around mid lane and waiting for the counter gank so they can win a 2v2.
Yeah. I mean, what's funny is it's so different to what his style was before, but as just a purely supportive jungler, he has become really good at that, actually. I have to give him props. He's developed in a way I didn't think he ever would as a top jungler, you know, because obviously before, yeah, as I've already referenced, as a player he was really good, but it was more like he broke the rules of what jungler is supposed to do. And unfortunately, when you break the rules of it in that sense, You're going to have to be an uber god to be better than the best junglers who basically follow the rules, because that's how you play the game. So I have to say he has developed in that sense.
I think he's been really good. And I think that because of the way he plays, it opens up so many sort of low wave clear or high scaling champions for pawn to pick. And that really helps out the team. So
I think basically, he still has a great pair of tits, Monty. But now what he did is it turned out his fashion sense was wrong before. When he got the right bikini, now his ass looks all right. Listen, it's not the best ass. He doesn't have that like god tier level ass, but he has a pretty good one. It's not the best. Okay, I still know there's a bit of cheating going on there. Part of it's the right bikini, the right lighting, the right location. You know, it's not pure natural. You know, so. That's my problem with Clearlove. Breaking it down for all the guys. So, my number four, Monty, we're already going to disagree because you've said this as much. My number four is actually still Deft. I still think he did have some issues in the playoffs, I'll admit as much. But, first of all, even just the totality of what he did in the summer, he still is the carry of the team in terms of the pure traditional carry roles. He's a fucking amazing player. And, again, he's a player who's developed. Like, the player, I thought Deft was amazing even in 2014, but I had slight reservations in as much as, like, the team style had to fit what he needed to do to cover a few of his weaknesses. When we say weaknesses, we're talking about relative to the best players in the world here. It still wasn't weak in any respect.
His laning phase was not great.
But that sort of a player, he very much, what's funny is the fact he replaced Nami. He very much was a Nami. He was a guy where he just did that cleanup style and, well, actually, cleanup's unfair because cleanup's usually associated with the players who aren't that good. He just did the style where you carry in the late game, essentially. That's the style. You team fight, carry late in the game just by auto-attacking or doing skill shots. Whereas,
It's just funny because you and I both have an EDG player there. It's just we're disagreeing on who the carry on this, the actual carry on this team is. I say it's Clearlove, especially if we consider the summer season.
Here we go. So here's why, Monty. You said, if you put any other jungler there, EDG as a team wouldn't be as good. Okay, I could maybe start to agree with that. Maybe other people would have issues. Here's the difference. I think if you put almost any other AD carry in with Clearlove, almost any, even maybe Imp, I don't know that they'd be as superlative as Deft is in the way he is. Like, here's something people don't give Deft credit for. Before he had his problems, he was playing anything he wanted to. He was playing all the shit that aren't even Deft Champ. He could just play Kalista if you want. Like, oh, okay, you have to ban that against me now as well. He could just play anything he wanted. He'd actually become like a complete... There's a period of time, I think, in the summer where he was probably the best player in the world to a degree.
In the summer? No. He wasn't playing as well in the summer as he did in the spring, I don't think. And even in the playoffs, like EDG still banning Kalista because they know that Imp's about a million times better on it than Deft is, and Deft still has those Kalista problems. You know, what's interesting to me, too, is that you had Clearlove at 13, right?
Yep.
I have Deft at 12. So basically, we just reversed the positions of those two particular players. If this was spring, Deft would be up there for me.
Okay.
But not in summer.
I also think at this tournament in particular, like, I'm not trying to break the rules by like imagining how he'll do, but I think at this moment right now, if he plays like he did in the playoffs before the regional, okay, admittedly, he's not going to be as good as my ranking says. That seems unlikely. But I think overall, when I think of his overall level, taking into account the slump and what I think he'll do this tournament, this is going to be like his tournament in terms of AD carries, along with him. I think those are the two that are just going to run over everyone.
I don't think anybody would really argue that they are the best AD carries at this tournament.
So who's the fifth player on your list, Monty?
Acorn.
Okay. Let's see. Why is that then?
So Acorn, I think, has been doing very well recently. And what I've been really impressed about LGD's performance is his teleport usage is still very good, which we knew him for it on blue. We've seen him play a lot of the very powerful top lane champions such as Fiora right now, be very successful like Someday in split pushing situations. He's got a great sense for the game. And he's pretty core to the way that LGD plays, because LGD is a team that really likes to five man the bottom side of the map with a couple of teleports and work it out just kind of that way and be very decisive in the way that they gank for their bot lane. And he's really on point with that. His laning is great. Again, a large champion pool to pick from. And he just continues to be a very stout and stalwart top laner. And I think that he's, and he's also up here because of the importance of the top lane at this particular time.
So my main problem with Akorn at that high up, because I have Akorn 10th.
Okay.
That's where he is for me. And the listen, 10th is still a fantastic player. You're 10th best in the world in this scenario. But my big problem is, I mean, I told you, I've already got two people from this team already on the list. So I've already got Imp and God V on the lineup.
Right. And you already have both of those guys in the top five, whereas I do.
Exactly. So that alone kind of shows that to me, I still think he's one of the best top laners in the world. If you want to talk about best top laners in the world, he's in my top five, obviously. And I could definitely debate my way up to probably like third or something, maybe. I think he's a very good player. The problem is, first of all, in the summer split, there was actually a period around the middle of the summer split where it's not even an exaggeration or wishful thinking to say that actually, when they were using Flame for a while, he was a better fit for the team. He was actually working better. He was even outperforming him for a little while. With that said, Akorn, his stint in LGD has actually won him so much respect for me, because he has shown that basically, kind of like what I was referring to with the Dandy example, basically he's shown me this year that he could do both sides of top lane play. Mm. Before, he was resigned to most of the time being the utility top, but now, as you saw even in the spring split, he can just play carry champions all the time if he wants and be really good at it. And now obviously is the ideal time to be able to do that. In the past, what was great about that was it meant in the right game, even if you, I can't imagine only what a nightmare it would have been fucking banning against LGD, because you're like, well, which is happening? Is it this game where he picks the Hecarim and shits all over us? Or is it this game where he just chills out and picks Rumble and plays the fucking utilities? You never know going into it. And so the level of impact he could have as a top laner, who I'm saying is not the best in his team, was, I mean, even in terms of the players in the game, I still think Imp and God V were the main carries. I still think was very high for, like, put it this way, of all the people I have as the third best player on their team, he's the best, obviously. That goes without saying.
Yeah.
It's a fucking amazing player. But I just didn't have him that high. I think 10's still pretty high. I think that's still pretty
good. Yeah, it is. I mean, we're still talking about that both of us have three LGD players in our top 10.
Yep.
Which is more than any other team that I have.
I mean, that was always the crazy thing about LGD. Okay, I understood why EGG won, because actually I think they're one of the only teams in the world that can say they have a better roster overall than LGD. But LGD has a fucking unreal roster. It wouldn't make sense to me if they didn't make Worlds, if they didn't have a chance to win. Because even with having, I mean, if anything, Monty, if they win Worlds, forget every other team in history, they're almost showing you that, like, it's actually possible for all that complaining about junglers. If you have a big enough exception, you really can win without a jungler, almost, you know. If every lane really does win, it almost doesn't matter if you have a jungler.
TBQ, to be fair, did have a pretty good performance in the playoffs, so...
Mate, I'd love to be in his position if I was a mediocre jungler.
Of course. I mean, if you think about it, you've got God V, Imp, and Akorn in your lane, so you don't even have to do much most of the time. Your lane's
and you play in the meta where the fucking top lane ganks bot lane. Like, what world is this?
Yeah, that's true.
Ridiculous.
And
it's double teleport time as well. Even easier.
And if you're LGD, you have God V, who loves to play TP Diana, so you actually get two people ganking the bot lane with you a lot of the time.
And in general, man alive, the guy has every lane is self-sufficient. He could actually play and have, like, keyboard problems, and if he just didn't say anything to the opponent, I bet he could probably win the game. They'd just be like, oh, he's having a quiet game here, but the lanes are still winning. He's like... It'd be ridiculous. So, okay. At number five, this is where, Monty, it shows how different the criteria is and how we come to these conclusions. Because you've already had Clearlove in your top fucking five players, which no one would expect. Meanwhile, Thorin, are you ready? Number five, rookie, former Katie Rolster mid laner. Yeah, that's right. Number five, mate, in the fucking Worlds. He shouldn't even be at Worlds in last year. But number five, yeah. My problem is...
I have rookie at eight, and he's just below God V. So we both have him below God V.
Yeah, both have him below.
I just think that the top lane is very important in this meta, but yeah, rookie is fucking good.
So here's the problem I have when I'm doing rookie, which is a positive for him. I don't care what anyone who's an old school Final League of Legends says about how wonderful the bot lane of Kid and Kitties is and how Zetai is really adapted to the top lane. I don't give a fuck, mate. When I look at that team, I'm like, of all the people who are in a team that's potentially got any chance to win this tournament, he's in the worst. Yes. He's in the worst of any team that has a chance to win this tournament.
Yes.
Not only in terms of the individual players, but like the overall style and how they all fit together cohesively. It's not a great mix.
Yes, it's not a great mix. They don't seem to communicate with each other particularly well either, so they have this scatterbrained approach a lot of the time.
So when I have this guy, and he is going head-to-head with God V, who's in fucking LGD, who have all those, every lane is monstrous, then he's going head-to-head with Pawn, where every other player on the team is one of the best at his role, and he's going head-to-head with these guys, and if he's losing, it's not by much. That makes me think, like, Jesus, this guy's good. Because at the end of the day, you know, okay, remember the series in the spring where IG played in the semi-finals against EDG, and everyone was like, haha, Pawn is shitting on you with anything. Imagine what a fucking nightmare it would be if the only person who spoke English on, Korean rather, on your team was your jungler. Everyone else on the team is speaking Chinese, and you're like having to play versus Pawn, who at any point in time with no pings could just go balls deep on you, like, and burn everything. You're like, what is this shit? What even is this? And all game long, you have to pick stuff that's going to work in your team comp. He's just picking stuff like, heh, I counterpicked you in lane. Enjoy the first 10 minutes, fucker. Like, what even is that? That's not... And even so, in general, aside from that one series, he does really well. He does really well. He's a really strong player. I think he's a player who... He's one of the players along... It's almost unfair to say he improved that much. He just had more chance to show us stuff, I think, this year.
Yeah.
Acorn did show us more. I think Rookie's a player who had legitimately improved when he went to China. I think he got better.
Yes, he did. He was, to be fair...
He was more one-dimensional, I think, in Korea.
He was still extremely good in Korea on KT sure. Arrows. And he's maintained his kind of very dual-focused play style. And he really likes to 2v2 in the mid lane with Kakao, obviously, because they're the only two people, like you said, that speak Korean on that team, I think, is a major factor. And because, of course, they have established synergy from KT Arrows, yeah. So it makes sense. But yes, he is a very good player. He's... one of the most fun players to watch because of how much he just likes to fight 1v1 or 2v2 in the mid lane. And we've just seen some spectacular plays. His Echo is really good. His Yasuo is really good. These are big picks for him, and he's been shining on that team for sure. And he is... I don't know how well his dual style would do with a different jungler, which kind of gives me pause. And I also think that while Rookie was great in the LPL playoffs, that I think he stepped it up, I will say, over the course of the summer season. He kind of just had a steady, I think, rise. But it was definitely the playoffs that made him look really good, I think.
Like, another thing is, obviously, I do have to take a little bit away from him as much as, yeah, he has an established synergy with his jungler, which some of those other people don't have. Like, for example, Pawn and Clearlove, again, one speaks Chinese, one speaks Korean. And then God V and TBQ, the less said, the better. So, okay, in as much as they get the advantage in the team, he gets the advantage in the jungler. I'll give you one thing that would... Okay, obviously, this has nothing to do with this list, but one way I think you could make Rookie even more insane in his impact, Monty. Here's all you'd have to do. The one thing I'd change... I'd make his top laner someone who had a wide enough champion pool to play flex picks that Rookie likes to play. And then it's over at that point. Imagine some of the flex picks stuff he can play mid that can go top. And how insanely... just it'd be impossible to pick bad against them, essentially.
Yasuo would be a really interesting one on that front, actually.
So he doesn't have that, but imagine if he did, you know. That's the one thing I can think of that could open it up more for him. And yeah, like I say, in his team... I mean, I mentioned before that for Pawn, the other two lanes can win. For fucking LGD, all three lanes can win. What fucking lanes are winning in IG games versus top teams? Let's get real, guys. It's on one dude's back.
Yeah, well, him and Kakao, yeah.
So, yeah, okay, that's number five for me. Number six, who do you have, Monty?
Kakao.
Okay.
So I actually have Kakao above both God V and Rookie, interestingly enough. He is the okay. highest member of IG. Though.
Finally, the bias has re-entered the equation here. Okay.
Okay, so there we
you
go.
You ready, Monty? Because I have Kakao number 12.
Interesting.
So why is Kakao at that position, Monty?
Because he is the one, like, first off, he's very unpredictable as a jungler. Sometimes he has a very farm-focused style. Sometimes he will just camp a lane and gank. So he's really difficult to prepare for because you don't know exactly what he's going to do. Sometimes I mean, he just farms up and becomes a major team fight threat in his own right. And that's certainly a very interesting style to play the game, because it just makes it really hard to predict exactly what he's going to be doing in any given situation. So he can be very dangerous in his unpredictability. He also, again, is extremely good with his synergy with Rookie, and a lot of the time, too, in terms of Zitai, on some of Zitai's less favorable matchups, he's able to give him enough of a boost to kind of like push him through. But if we look at sort of junglers, I think Kakao is a jungler that has just such an enormous impact on the game compared to most other junglers in this particular tournament. That, first off, I just think he's more core to the way the team functions than Rookie is. I think he could, if you replaced Rookie with another great mid laner, that feeding that mid laner would be ultimately successful, but I'm not sure if you could actually operate IG without Kakao.
Like, I have Kakao as my best jungler in the tournament, which in itself obviously is a debatable point, because I do still think, again, he's not on a great team. He's playing with people who, aside from his mid laner, are Chinese. So I can only imagine what a fucking joke that must be as a jungler to try and do, where of all the positions you need to communicate in League of Legends, surely junglers like numero uno. So that's pretty insane. I mean, put it this way. Everyone watching right now has played solo queue, presumably. You know when you send a ping to the top laner, and the problem is, in your mind, that ping could mean check this brush, and then he goes and face checks it, or it might have meant there's someone in that brush, and then he goes face checks it, or it might mean put a ward in that brush. Pings are actually pretty terrible. There's not enough variety to them. There needs to be like five subcommands to them or whatever. If he's really communicating via pings on any of these ganks, holy moly, you must have to just like...
Well, there is like a warning ping, obviously, if you don't face check this or whatever.
Okay.
Yes.
To a degree,
I agree.
Yeah,
but here's another factor that I think puts Kakao way up on this list. So we always talk about the importance of synergy between jungler and support.
Yep.
And out of the top six teams at this tournament, Kitties is the worst support player by a lot. Not even by a little, like by a really significant margin. Now, Kidd and Kitties, I think, overperformed towards the end of the season. In fact, they did a lot better than I thought they would. IG obviously did a lot better than I thought they would as a team. And Kidd and Kitties' individual performances had a big impact on that. But man, imagine trying to get vision control when your fucking support is Kitties.
I mean, you have to realize, Munchie, I think Kakao's a phenom. I wish I had him top five or top six. I wish that's where he was. And the problem is, I also think he's someone who really benefited from IG's playoff run. Like, there was times in the season where I would watch his games, and it reminds me of when I used to watch the old Dandy in, except not as bad, when he was actually the jungler in VG, where I'd keep watching, like, what is this? Like, this guy was just, it's like he couldn't fail when he was in OGN, and sometimes you have games where it's just like, it's humbling. It makes you realize how much of a team-focused game League of Legends is in 2015, unfortunately, where you can't just be a god and then still carry every game. That almost doesn't happen. The people who do that are gods, and they have the sick team behind them. That's just a fact at this point in time. You really can't do it on your own anymore. So, yeah, that's the only problem. As I think he had some weak games during the split, and
yeah, that's fair.
I think people sometimes let him off with it because he's Kakao, and some of the reasons I've said, shit team, etc. But yeah, unfortunately, the Kakao of 2014, I don't think, within that context, did that stuff back then. He was a bit more unreal at the time, with equally bad teammates sometimes.
Yeah, I mean, when we talk about Kakao's history of support players, it hasn't been great.
Yep.
If you think about Kakao's history, probably the best support player he's ever played with is Mafa. That's
exactly
weird to say.
And that's a guy who was like super meta dependent to be a good player.
And now Mafa is Kakao's coach.
So my pick for number six. Are you ready, Monty? Because now this is great because number six is the bias pick. Okay, so let me see if you can guess. Who do you think Thorin? Since I've just said it's a bias pick, who do you think Thorin has at number six?
I don't know, dude.
Take a guess. Who do you think I would be biased in favor of? What sort of position do I like? What type of player do I want in that position? See if you can guess.
Is it Flame?
No, obviously not. Flame's not even on the list, bro. You don't even play the games. That'd be ridiculous if I had Flame on my list. It's not that bad, mate. It has to be reasonable still. I mean, if I'm going to do that, mate, I'm just putting number one, right? He's better than Faker.
Thorin. If I thought that you operated on making reasonable decisions. Yeah. Half the shit that comes out of your mouth wouldn't come out of your mouth.
But here's the thing, Monty. You're on sort of the right track. You're on sort of the right track. See if you can guess. I'll give you one more guess.
The Kerry top laner thing.
Are you ready? So who is it then, do you think?
Which of the Kerry top laners?
Yeah, which one does Thorin favor?
Smeb.
Of course. Of course it's Smeb, mate. If you want to talk, listen, you know it's a man's world. And that is a man's position. The top laner is still the position. Because now, Monty, you know, remember in season 4 when they started to give us these fucking junglers were coming top lane all of a sudden? Then they took them away from us. Now we had to teleport all the time. Now the jungler's fucking going everywhere else on the map, working with the support. Get the fuck away from the support. He's supposed to be the butler of the AD carry. You're meant to be my butler. Where's my butler gone? I was enjoying that life. I was living the dream. Now I'm doing shit for myself again. But this is a man's man, mate. Like, you look at any of the other top laners on the list, okay? I don't know who else we've got. I don't want to spoil anything. But presumably, okay, we've already said Someday. We've already said Acorn. You look at the team that Smeb has. This boy is a hard carry, mate.
Yep.
This guy's a fucking monster. And the key thing I've noticed that's really interesting is it's true his team can at times be mentally weak and they have failed in like playoffs and they failed at the IEM. In general, though, I don't think he's been very weak, actually. He seems like he's pretty mentally strong. Like, he can lose, but I think he fucking goes out all guns blazing.
So my issue with Smeb and why I have him lower, I actually have him as 9 on my list, and I have him behind Someday and Acorn, is that while Smeb is definitely the hard carry of that team, he's definitely an exceptional top laner, and he and Gorilla are the only players from KU I even have on my top 20. Yeah. And he's been very consistent, it's true, and he has a huge champion pool, and he's been an innovator in the meta. Like, he brought Malphite back, you know, or kind of Malphite for the first time ever really into the competitive scene. So KU Tigers were responsible for that. He had a really good playoff run, I think. They barely lost to KT. So why I would put Smeb lower, and he's also the shot caller for the team, so there's that to consider too. So Smeb,
you know how I love those shot callers.
So when you talk about the mental fortitude, right? That's my big question, because in the past when KU has gone on tilt, what happens is Hojin starts like repeatedly ganking top lane for Smeb, and I wonder if it's Smeb tilting and just being like, I have to carry this game, jungler come up here, whether it makes sense or not. And a lot of the time it doesn't make sense. Now, we didn't
see... You know, I'm forgiving of that sort of problem in players,
mate. I know you are.
That's my weakness. What can I tell you?
The flame Helios condition.
Yeah, but exactly.
It's true. But in that particular instance, now, what we didn't see was that happen during the latest playoff run, which was good because we saw at IEM. We saw it when KU Tigers played against SK Telecom in the finals for spring. They had that same problem in two like very high-pressure matches, but then we didn't see it in the summer playoffs. So that gave me hope that that's not going to happen anymore. But that's kind of my question mark about Smeb as a player. But obviously, I mean, he's amazing. He does have that flexibility. We've seen him. He's a Riven god. He can play so many different champions. He can innovate new champions that become meta picks. He's definitely great. So like I said, he's 9 on my list.
And also, here's the thing. He can be just a straight hard carry. Like, I think he's at his best. If you were to design a team around him, you'd make him the super hard carry top laner. But of all the ones who really, that's their natural predilection, man alive, is this guy good on the fucking utility tops as well.
Yes.
Like, put this boy on Rumble, Gnar, Maokai. He's going to do work. This guy's really good. Yeah. I mean, yeah, just fantastic player overall. It was a really wide champion. But actually, I think when people talk about wide champion, people, yeah, they talk about Someday and in the past Cora won and Acorn now. This guy's got a really wide champion pool as well.
Yep, very good. I agree.
Okay, so let's go down. Okay, so what is number 8? I've already referenced mine. No, mine's rookie.
Number seven.
Let me see. Ah, you have God V, right?
I have God V at 7. Well, from the reasons we were debating about where God V should be earlier on, right?
Okay. So then I'll tell you who I have at number 7, okay? So this might already be shocking. Number 7, I actually have Gorilla, support player of KU Tigers.
Interesting. I have him at 11.
Okay, I'll put that in there. So here's the thing about Gorilla. I actually think support is a role that got so fucked up by the people leaving to China. Because Mata went off, and unfortunately, unless he plays like an absolute god, he's never even going to be relevant anymore because his team isn't relevant anymore. So Mata's deleted from the mapping, essentially. You look elsewhere.
Gone like several AD carries.
Yep. And there's none of them stuck. And then you look elsewhere. Mako He's playing very well. It looks impressive at times. But what an incredible team he plays on.
Yeah,
he plays on an unreal team.
Yeah, he does. And also, as good as Mako is and as good as the Clear Love Mako synergy is, I was not as impressed by Mako's performance in the summer as I was in the spring. So that Mako's not on my list for that reason.
I also think he's the most replaceable member of EDG. Like, I think he could live without, 100%. Without him.
100%, I agree.
You go over to PYL, again, the guy's team is bananas. It's absolutely bonkers, the team this guy's playing on. And he's, by the way, his AD carry is just only the number two player on our fucking list, unanimously. We all agreed upon. Then you look at who Gorilla's working with. Prey was in a coffin. Okay, Monty, you know there's a thing they used to actually do in England, where when they buried people back in the day, when like medicine hadn't come that far, they would actually put a little piece of string that went through a little hole in the coffin up to the top,
with
a little bell. And the idea was, if you weren't quite dead, but you'd been buried, everyone thought you were dead, you could ring that bell and if you quickly woke up, okay. That's what Prey had to do to get Gorilla to come and fucking raise him from the dead. And man alive, this, when their synergy, when they work well together, he makes Prey look so good. And Prey's a good player. Don't get me wrong, he's still a good player, still above average AD carry. But Gorilla, that's the dream, is your support player right now.
And even so, Prey looked very good in the playoffs, but yes, I think Gorilla's a big part of that. And Prey also, but by that token, Prey also kind of fell off about halfway through the summer season and had some very poor positioning there for a while, and actually was a lot of the reason why Ku was losing. But Gorilla as a player, not only does he have to like have Prey, who I think he's better than Prey and he helps Prey a lot, Gorilla also likes to gank for Smeb. Like, he'll just show up in top lane. He'll just recall and just leave Prey down there by himself and just show the fuck up to start feeding Smeb. And he is so core to how that team operates because he works well with Hojin to set up plays on the map and to make plays on other lanes. Even in standard lane situations, sometimes he'll just, like, peace out and go to top lane. So his sense of where to be, because we know Ku Tigers has a relatively shaky laning phase, even though it did look like it was getting better at some points. They're not a team that wins due to monstering you in lane. They win due to their mid and late game shot calling. And Gorilla is there to sort of prop up their laning phase. And if it wasn't for Gorilla's sense of where to be on the map and how to like help his team out in the laning phase, I don't think Ku Tigers even works as a team. So he's really good. I had him at 11, but is he my highest rated support player? Yes, he is.
And also, like, here's the thing about that guy. Of support players, this guy's champion pool fucking melts my brain. First of all, let's just start with the classics. This guy's a fucking Janna god. Everyone knows that. He's probably the best Janna player ever. His Thresh, he hasn't even had to use it in the last few months. It's always been on point, though. That's the one that got him famous in the first place. Then, after that, he just starts picking from whatever makes sense at the time. He'll pick out Nami. He'll go with fucking Annie. As Alistair, when that became in meta, became ridiculous as well.
He is actually, I believe... He lost one game on Alistair. He lost one game, I think. Oh, wait. I'm going to look it up real quick, because he may still be professionally undefeated on Alistair. So let me pull it up. Maybe, if I can. So, right. I think Inven is now blocked outside of Korea. That's fun. So I can't check right now.
I'll look on eSportpedia for you. Let me have a look.
I don't know if they'll actually have
Apparently in the summer playoffs, he lost two Alistair games, but he was undefeated in the regular split.
He was undefeated professionally up until the summer playoffs. Okay. So yeah, that changed. I thought it had changed.
Right.
But I mean, obviously, before that point, he had an extremely good record on Alistair, and he picked up Kennen very quickly. So yes, he's a very versatile player.
And I think what makes him so fun to watch is that he can play those like playmaker champions, that he can be like a Thresh, etc. But on those champions like the Janna and the Nami, this guy's what a great finesse player as well. This guy reminds me, he's almost like a combo of like the playmaking qualities of like the Mad Life, etc. Not quite that crazy, obviously, and he's not going to do that in his team, but he's got like that Pumandu really finesse precision style as well. That's just, that works sick for the team. It's like a team player as well.
Yeah, and that's what I think that out of all his champion pool, out of all the issues you've raised, which are all important, I think my favorite thing about Gorilla, like I said, is he really knows where to be on the map at precisely the right time. And that's so important. Especially because he has a very average jungler to work with in Hojin.
Yeah, exactly. That's another example of like a synergy where it's stressed, but I mean, what the fuck's he working with there? So, okay. I mean, the great thing about Hojin is he literally changed name at a couple of games. People were like, the new jungler for Ku's way better, isn't he? It's like, that's the same guy actually, mate. Like, oh, okay. That's how bad Hojin is, mate. Like, no one even cared. Everyone just assumed he'd been shanghaied out of there. Although nowadays, I guess in League of Legends, shanghaied out of there means something quite different. So anyway, who knows? Maybe he'll be the starting jungler for EDG next split. Yeah, exactly.
Everybody's just hoping to get shanghaied these days. How times have changed, right?
So, let me see. Okay, you already told us your number 8. Your number 8 was Rookie.
Yes.
So my number 8 was Someday. So we've already done that one. That's the one we've done already. Now, number 9 for you was Smeb.
Yep.
And number 9 for me was Peekaboo, so we've done that one.
Oh, we haven't talked about Peekaboo yet.
Oh, right. That's right. I'm the first one to pick him.
I have Peekaboo much lower. I have Peekaboo at 16.
We're reversing biases, Monty. Maybe people don't know this, but maybe just to fuck with lolesports, we swapped lists. It's like, yeah, not, I have Clearlove number 5 because I am not biased about China and I like Koreans and Chinese equally. So, okay.
That's not true. I only have 3 Chinese players on my list.
I only have 2, mate. So, again, I've done you there, mate. I've got you. I got more Koreans than you, mate. Actually, I don't think I have a supermod, but anyway. So, yeah, I have Peekaboo there. The problem with this is the real thing you have. That's why I made you define at the beginning of the criteria. With Peekaboo, this is where I feel like the LoL esports, as the very little exposition we got on their pick between Peekaboo and Elframu, what I felt was really unfair. Either they did a very bad job of articulating it with multiple opportunities to do so, or they just straight up have criteria which are mutually exclusive and yet they're applying at the same time or one after another, if you know what I mean. Like, basically, if you're counting right now, like who are the best players right now, you can definitely have Peekaboo, not only on the top 20, quite high up, in fact. He's very influential on his team, very good individual player, very good player in his lane, very good player matching up against other players at his position. He's got a whole lots of things going for him. Now then, if you're counting all of 2015, and you're counting all your success in 2015, hey, there's lots of knocks against him. He barely even started playing till the last, whatever it was, 10 games or something. He wasn't playing in the spring season. There's all these factors that go against him. But again, which is it? Do you count?
Well, hold up. To be fair, Peekaboo may have only played in the summer season in 9 best of threes, but he actually played more games than any LCS player did.
Okay.
Just a point.
But did he win in Madison Square Garden? Yeah, the witness will reply yes or no, and it is instructed not to speak any further. Yeah, that's how they get you, Monty. That's basically, you'd think you'd go and be an expert witness against LoL esports. They'd break you on the cross, mate. They'd use those lawyer tactics, and if you tried to go like, but wait, actually, in Korea, it's more important. They'd be like, in contempt of court, take him away. And let's face it, Monty, don't, please, just for my sake, don't ever go and try and speak as a star witness or go and stand on the trial and defend your opinions about League of Legends, because you will definitely be in contempt of court. I'm just telling you right now. I don't know who the judge is, but it's going to happen. Because the judge will be like, okay, fucking, it'll be like Liquid 112 or something, mate. It'll just be over for you at that point in time. So,
and then, my punishment will be to be a Korean dick sucker until the end of time.
I mean, in many ways, isn't it already? You know, so anyway, are you shocked that I have Peekaboo so high up then, Monty?
No. I can understand reasoning behind Peekaboo being up that high. I just think that with Peekaboo, for me, what's amazing about him as a player is that obviously he hasn't been able to practice as much as a lot of the other players due to his wrist issues, and he had to do a transition. He was playing well in SKT when he was able to play, and with SKT, they didn't bench him for performance reasons. They benched him because they wanted his fucking wrist to heal. And Peekaboo's sort of response to that was to decide not to renew his contract and go to a team and just keep playing, right? So that's a choice that he made. But for when he came onto KT, obviously he made a big difference. His performance wasn't everything. Clearly some other stuff worked, but he made a massive immediate impact. In the first round robin of summer, KT was 5-4. In the second round robin of summer, KT was 8-1, and they only lost to SKT. Now, in that 8-1, there is a bit of an asterisk because they did lose a lot of dumb games to like Spenu and IM, like single games that, you know, it shouldn't have gone to 3 games in that series. So there was an upset potential there, which is why in the group stages of Worlds, I do think KT can drop games. You know, if they can drop a game to Spenu, they sure as hell can drop a game to Origin, right? But Peekaboo was such a revelation. Not only did Arrow's like CS numbers go up, and Arrow has been a player who's been having issues in lane, he came back to a team where he already had an established synergy from Arrow. They played together back on Zenix Storm, right? And Score, who is a jungler that was looking good but didn't really have that synergy, Score and Peekaboo have one of the strongest jungle support synergies at Worlds. And they developed it really, really fast. Peekaboo is also the major shot caller on that team. I've been in the same room as KT while they're scrimming, so I can tell Score and Peekaboo are the ones who are always talking. And he makes a lot of decisions for that team. And he is, I mean, if you lane swap against this guy, he is a fucking nightmare. He will be in your lane at level one, trying to kill your mid laner with Nagne. He will get in your jungle with Score and try and kill your jungler. Like, he's so aggressive and he's so fun to watch. Now, the dark side of Peekaboo is sometimes he gets caught out doing this shit and he dies. But rarely do Peekaboo's deaths lose KT games. You know what I mean? It's not like Peekaboo dying gets the team a crucial objective. He dies more often, but the stakes are not so high around him dying, whereas the rewards of him playing this aggressive style are often reaped by KT. So
I have to say, Peekaboo's...
He is a bit of a double-edged sword, though, and he also didn't play the best in either the finals or the gauntlet. Like, I think we saw better play out of him in the regular season. So he didn't have the strongest finish to the summer season with the playoffs and the gauntlet run. So that's sort of my reservation about Peekaboo and why I ranked him a bit lower, even though I really love him as a player and I love watching him and I think he's very good.
With the Peekaboo issue, I think we have to reference something that we didn't really talk about so far, which is I do have kind of a concern with Peekaboo when you talk about how you rank shot calling as an individual quality. Because to me, first and foremost, this type of a list is an individual list, in as much as it's individual. I'm bringing in team concepts, like how much of a focal point are you in the team, but for example, just to give you an example here, Hai is a fantastic shot caller, but he would never come a million miles close to this list, because for him to be on this list, I could count shot calling as part of his good qualities,
right?
And obviously he has that over many junglers who aren't shot callers, but his individual play is nowhere near them, so he doesn't have any of the other quality.
Right.
Imagine shot calling could count for a sixth of your overall score. Well, he's so bad in the other five, six, he's not even on the map, okay? The problem I have is I get the feeling a lot of other people make shot calling this ultimate cherry on the top. So that as a result, say you're talking about, obviously, listen, I'm not going to spoiler, so there's going to be names we'll talk about later. There are certain players, primarily at support position, where if they're a good support and they win, and then on top of it, they shot call, some people I feel like it boosts them too much. They make it like they're untouchable, because unless the other person in their position or who you're comparing is a shot call, well, how could they match up? You know, they're shot calling as well. That gets really murky, I think, when you're on an individualist. I count it, but it's not like an overriding factor for me.
Even if that's ignored, Peekaboo is still very good.
Yeah, yeah. That's one of my key points I'm making here, is that, listen, you could, even if I made it so that I banned shot calling, that's not counted on this list, he'd still be on my top 20. He's still a really good player.
Right. And, for example, if we were to rate shot calling higher, then we'd have to rate players like Marin and Smeb maybe better than Someday.
Sure.
Well, which I think you did.
Some of us do, mate. So, you know. Listen. Horses for courses, mate. So going down, number 10. I've already said my number 10 was Akon. What is Monty's number 10?
Marin.
Here we go. Why is Marin number 10?
So he also is a top laner that gets a lot of resources.
By the way, can I just say, I the world hasn't noticed this, Monty. They haven't realized what you've just said. But I just want to clarify, on today is the 24th of September 2015, Monty just officially confirmed Smeb is better top laner than Marin. So that's over, guys. It's over. The dark days are behind us. We're all moving forwards together, united as one. So, okay, tell me again about Marin.
So Marin's actually, I have four top laners in my top 10. And part of that is because, again, we're looking at the players who are going to have the best performances at Worlds. And this patch is very top lane focused, right? Yeah. So we're going to have more top laners up there regardless. So why Marin's up there? Like Someday, he does get a lot of resources focused, you know, funneled into him. That's very true of Marin. And we saw in the finals, when these two players matched up, Marin did extremely well in the lane when he got some counter picks in onto Sunday, and he had a great performance. My concern about Marin is we don't know, and this could change at Worlds. We know he plays Fizz into Maokai as like a counter pick, but that's not going to be quite so relevant at the World Championship. But we also don't really know what Marin can do when it comes to a lot of bruisers or playing like more carry-oriented top laners, right? He hasn't been the one like Smeb and Someday that's been playing Riven or Yasuo, Rumble.
He's been a bit too mainstreamed in the
championship. He's been Maokai and Rumble like a lot.
Yeah, very mainlined.
And some of these champions have received nerfs or may not have that same priority. Now, Marin is something like, he's on like a 24-game win streak as Maokai, something absolutely ridiculous like that. And that's going to be an option. But I just don't know if Marin can be up there with Acorn and Someday and Smeb when it comes to Fiora play, GP play, you know, that those kind of questions. And Marin also is not as good at split pushing as some of these other players. He has a tendency to underward and get killed and over pursue in lane in his 1v1. So Marin's a very good top laner. I just think he's like fourth best at Worlds.
Yeah, there's also the problem, let's just term it the faker factor, which is part of the reason why he can get away with winning a billion games in a row on Maokai and people don't just go, I think I will ban Maokai out of one of my three bans, is because I'd rather have him popping in on Maokai than Faker getting flavor of the month that he is wrecking everyone's open weeping buttholes with in solo queue. So that's what you ban out, boys. You don't go, ban out Maokai, he's got a great win rate. Yeah, Faker might have no win rate on this thing, mate, but he's going to destroy the whole team, isn't he?
Yeah, exactly. And also, I think Marin is fortunate in that Faker can do a lot with very few resources, which means that Marin gets more resources. It's also true that Bengi, one of the factors in the finals was that SKT tried really hard to shut down Someday. Really hard. And they were successful. Yeah. But Bengi, especially in the Gangplank game, was just ridiculously diving top over and over and over again.
Yeah, so here's the thing. I have Marin on my list. He's number 15 on my list, so not too far off. But for many of the reasons I gave here, first of all, when you start talking about top laners, Korea still has a whole gang of really good top laners. And at the moment, it's not just the meta. Top lane as a position is also very strong right now. Some really fantastic players. And also a number of players who can do both styles as well. That's what's been so impressive. It isn't such a hard divide as we used to think of in the past. So I think Marin's problem is, in general, he has shown himself to be more of a tendency towards like the Nar Maokai type player, you know. And he hasn't really been able, compared to some of these other fantastic players, positions.
His Fizz is really good, which gives me hope, but he just doesn't have the same depth of champion pool, it's true.
I mean, put it this way, I really suspect if he could have played Gangplank, they wouldn't have been banning it, they would have just taken it against Someday, especially if they're fucking picking the way they were. So I think that that's, it's a worrying trend going into the Worlds, Monty. The biggest diss I can ever give.
I think Marin will pick up these champions and do fine on them. I think that's true. But
also, I'm not gonna dismiss the idea that he could one day be an even better player. Maybe he could be. Maybe he keeps developing. But I did listen, guys. Anyone who's gonna talk shit now, like, yeah, but you don't know. He's got Faker on his team. Of course, it's gonna make it harder to carry that, mate. I sat through all those 2014 SKTS games. Shut the fuck up. It wasn't hard carrying the shit out of everything. He was doing it sometimes, and they were like 65-minute games, and I would have asked for my money back and said, boo, even when they won some of those games, because those weren't good games, mate. They were terrible games.
They were, actually, you know what's funny is SKTS is probably my least favorite team to cast of all time.
Terrible, aren't they?
They were just, it was so horrible to watch.
Like, at least when Nadja and Whiteshield do a 50-minute game, it's some insane thing where they win with, like, just with the minions, and you're like, yeah. Jesus, how do you even set that up? Or when Blaze do it, they get the godlike team fight where Flame and Ambition come in. Those were the most underwhelming wins I've ever seen in my life.
They were horrible. They were so bad.
It's like they tried to scientifically prove the minimum possible margin you can win a game of League of Legends by. It was terrible. So yeah, anyway, let's move down then. So that was number 10. So I had Acorn there. So number 11 is where Monty had Gorilla.
Yes.
Now, here we go, Monty. Are you ready? Ooh. You ready? See, so far on my list, Monty, I've been all about Dem Asians. I'm loving Dem Asians. I've got Asians all over the place. I'm basically like exactly what I said I wasn't going to do, Monty. I'm just all over the top teams, picking out the best players. I've got another Asian here, but at number 11, I've got Hooney.
Ooh.
Yeah, you're liking that, aren't you? The way I play the foreign card, suddenly they're all on my side, Monty.
See,
what are you going to do now, Professor Korean Dick Sucker? He's even Korean, and it's going to be used against you. That's how fucked this is, Monty. It's not even fair, is it?
It's not. I don't have Hooney on my list.
Oh, boy. Okay, well, that's one thing I will say, Monty. You said you only have four top laners. Listen.
No, I had four top laners in the top 10.
How many top laners overall?
Oh, I guess I only do have four top laners.
Really? Thorin has seven top laners.
Holy shit.
Yeah, welcome to top lane, baby. You know, season 4, top lane hell. Season 5, top lane paradise.
Interesting.
Paradise.
We're really going to disagree on some of these lower picks.
No, there's going to be some mad ones later, mate. It gets crazy.
Okay, so why I don't have Hooney on here. Hooney is like a lesser version of Marin. And I know that's not going to be popular for me to say, but when I say that, I mean champion pool. Hooney was very reliant on picks like Hecarim, which he was exceptional at, or like a limited number of picks that, you know, we got to see a lot of bans against his Hecarim and his Rumble, and that was, you know, important. He also did break out a little bit. He always had some weird picks, so we know he has a relatively good champion pool, whether it's like Cassiopeia or that Lee Sin that really was terrible. But the thing for me is that Hooney, I felt, was less dominant in summer than he was in spring, even though the record was better I think he had to carry less with Reckless and like Febiven getting a lot better and deepening Febiven's champion pool. So the other thing is, we saw him in the finals at summer really struggling on the Gangplank. And that makes me curious as to what exactly that's going to mean for Worlds when he doesn't seem to be comfortable on some of the more contemporary picks in this meta. So I think Hooney's a good top laner. I think that he had a very good rookie season, extraordinary rookie season. I felt that part of the changes in summer was that he didn't have to carry as hard, so he wasn't put in that position quite as much. But I just have some reservations about him based on the playoff run that Fnatic had.
So the thing that makes putting even ranking Hooney difficult is that, I mean, I've already said it on Summoning Insight in the past, people can get mad if they want, but purely as players outside the context of the team, I actually think Febiven's a better player than he is. I think they're destined to be a better player in history. Now, that might sound like a crazy comment.
So
the reason why
Febiven's on my top 20.
Okay, so the reason why I have Hooney there instead, though, is because, again, kind of like the pawn factor I brought in before, as fantastic as Febiven is, he doesn't always have to do some of those things to win the game, and that's not his role necessarily. Really, Fnatic still, in many ways, it's Hooney's the tip to the spear. He's the way in many ways that they dominate the game.
Yes, and Hooney has played. He did diversify, I think, a lot. I mean, he played a lot of different champions throughout the summer season and playoffs. He played 11 different champions, actually. So we saw a pretty wide variety of picks from him. And, you know, his Echo was great when the Echo came out. He even has, like, mixed in the Riven in there, so we know he's got that pick as well. But I don't know, man, like, I just didn't feel as good about Hooney in the summer as I did in the spring.
Okay.
But I think that's also a consequence of Fnatic having a more well-rounded team with the development of Febiven and then getting rid of Steelback.
So who is number 12 for you, Monty? Because number 12 for me was Kakao.
So who was Deft. It for
you? Okay, so we did that one already. Okay, so number 13 for me was Klarlov. Who was 13 for you?
Pawn.
Pawn made the list. How is that?
Pawn made the list for me. Well, I'm not LOL Esports last year where Pawn was not on the list at all.
Apparently you're fucking China Talk, mate. You've got four players from LGD on. Okay, China Talk, Monty. Explain to me
this
why.
This is EDG.
Oh, right. Yeah, my bad. He's on EDG. Okay. Okay, you've only got the three players on there then, Monty. So basically, Coral 1 saved you your fucking dignity by not turning up to this tournament. You would have had 4 on, wouldn't you?
Well, Coral 1 might be here. I don't even know. He's listed as the
star. If he'd have been playing the whole summer split, mate, you'd have had to have 4, and then I'd be asking you why you've got 4 for all these teams on. So.
No, I would not.
Okay, so why is Pawn in the top 20?
Why is Pawn in the top 20? So, I think that Pawn's versatility is a huge asset, and that his large champion pool is extraordinarily helpful. He can play so many different styles for EDG. I do think that why he's lower on my list at, 13, is that he isn't that major carry on EDG. But his flexibility is actually really quite impressive, and how he can be a workhorse for the team and do kind of whatever they need to do to effectively run a strategy or to neutralize another player, which we saw, of course, famously at MSI in Game 5 when Faker picked LeBlanc. The ability for him just to pull the Morgana out of his ass was actually quite important. So, I mean, Pawn, for the most part, had a very good summer season. Obviously, EDG won the overwhelming majority of their games. The team as a whole hiccuped during the playoffs, but then they roared right back during the actual qualifiers. So Pawn to me he provides so much versatility as a player that enables EDG to do a lot. And I think that is an undervalued trait.
So, okay, this is a topic I'm going to do a video on soon, actually, Monty. It's going to be a rare video where what I contrast is a CSGO player and a League of Legends player. Because we have a player who's just like Pawn in CSGO. It's the player JW for Fnatic. And at the moment, Fnatic is the best team in the world. They've been the best team for maybe 12 months, I think, roughly 12 months now. They've been the best team overall, and they've won the most tournaments, they've won tons of majors, they've won all these fantastic accomplishments. Yet within that period of time, JW has never been the best player on the team. It's always been someone else. And in fact, his team has turned out to be almost Samsung White-esque in terms of they've had a whole bunch of players who almost had like 3 months where they were the star, and then 3 months they took off and they just became a utility player. 3 months someone else was the star. And so he's had all this talent around him. And the key thing about JW, to contrast to Pawn and his two teams he's been in, is that what he had was he had the most stable, by the numbers, really good team where every other piece made total sense how it fit together. The other synergies were what were amazing. It's almost like the other three or four players synergized amazingly well, were really good players in their own right, played the game as a team concept, and that allowed him to sort of be the shaman who's outside of the tribe and can operate independently but has some link to it, okay? And so what happens is they only bring him in when they need him. When they need him to do something, when they need something from him, some information, they bring him in, he does that, then he goes out otherwise. He goes off to live outside. So in CSGO, what this means is JW basically plays a role that almost no one else in the game plays, where he essentially is allowed free reign to do anything he wants. He can buy the most expensive gun in the game, the AWP, which is a sniper rifle, which now, since it was nerfed, you're mainly supposed to use in a static fashion, pick an angle, hold it, and then give the information and try and get the kills. He's still allowed to use it as though it was actually really aggressive. He can push forwards, go into where the enemy is, there might be three enemies there, peek out and kill one. Okay, he's killed one, you've got a numbers advantage. No, he'll then peek out and kill another guy, and then he'll peek out and try and kill the third one. And here's the thing, the reason it works is because say he peeks out the first guy and he just dies and doesn't get a single kill, and you're 4v5. The rest of his team is so good at the team concept, it's so built not around having to have him, that they'll win anyway, or they can win anyway. So the added bonus of when he does get away with that makes you nearly unstoppable, and here's the key factor that I'm going to make the point of in the video. It makes the whole team spend part of their time focusing on you, the wild card, where really that's not even what's going to beat you. And that's really dangerous, because then people are thinking, in CSGO, it's like, where's he going to be, and what's he going to do there, so you're more cautious. In League of Legends terms, it's like, should we ban one of his champions? Will he just pick something else anyway? Should we try and ganking, or should we, you know, as a result, are we just going to let the bottom lane get out of control? You know, these are the questions you have to ask when you play EDG. So in a way, I think with Samsung White and EDG, you almost couldn't pick teams out of any players that would exaggerate how good his playing style is more than these teams. Put him in any other team and he could be a carry, but he'd be an inconsistent one.
I can see that, which is why he's below many other mid laners on my list, but I also think you can't underrate the way that Clearlove and he play together to get him ramped on champions that really need time to scale, which is what we were talking about Clear Love earlier. So I do think there's a good amount of synergy there, and that his flexibility and the way the team, like you're saying, they, to a certain degree, they play around him and his picks, just adds a lot of depth to ADG and their available strategies.
Like, put it this way, when Koro won in spring season, was ridiculously good. He might have been the best top player in the world. When he was on form, I'm not even exaggerating, I thought Pawn was like the fourth best player on EDG. Because I had it as like Koro won,
yep.
Deft were both like top two. Then you had Clear Love. So you get, it's fourth before you even get a Pawn.
Yep.
So that shows how fantastic his team was. So, obviously Koro won might not even play here. Amazing J is not the player that Koro won was. So, in general, I just have a hard, he's one of those players where I don't have him on the list just because he fails the focal point part for me. Like, he fails it so much that I can't think of him as a star player, really. And really, this is a list. Okay, my list essentially is for star players in general. You have to be a star in some sense to be on my list.
I agree. You have some compelling arguments. Maybe I put Pawn too high.
So, okay. I do think
that he belongs in the top 20, yeah.
This is where it starts to get crazy, mate. What do you have for number 14?
You're not going to like this one either. I have PYL.
Okay, so let me check. You've got Imp.
Yep, I have four players from LGD.
You got four players from this team.
Mm-hmm.
How does that work?
Well, I also happen to think that LGD is a team that thrives based on their kind of raw talent.
Yeah, sure. That's why they were the team that could do all that shit without a coach after
the time. Yeah, exactly. So I think it's reasonable to put four of the LGD players on this list.
Why is PYL that high?
I think he's just a fucking fantastic support player. I think he plays extremely well in lane swap situations. He works very well around TBQ and Acorn to facilitate the lane swaps, make sure people get their farm, make sure that he's in the right place at the right time. He has great synergy with Imp in the laning phase. He makes sure a lot of the time that TBQ isn't off doing something extremely stupid. And I think he's like, we talk about jungle support. This is such a lopsided synergy in favor of PYL, even though TBQ had a stronger end to the season, that I think there's so much to like about PYL as a support.
Because my problem with PYL, it's kind of like the Pawn one, I guess. I guess he's the biggest victim of the fact that I don't want to have, like, I'm trying to make it a star list, and I'm not just going to pick people who are really good in their position, but that's also relative to having a phenomenal team and being in an insanely good position. I guess he's the biggest victim in that sense. I do think he's a very good support player, but I can't have four people from one list, man. That's too much for me. I can't have four people from one team. Like, it's just too much. Yeah, I can't rationalize having it. So myself, I've just discounted him for that reason. Not on my list at all. So my number 14, are you ready?
Oh boy.
My number 14 is Yellow Star.
Okay.
Here we go. So here's the problem.
That's fair. So I have Yellow Star at 18.
Okay, let me put that in. So I will say, to start off with, that's why I prefaced earlier on the Peekaboo one about, that's who I was essentially referring to in not exactly veiled terms about don't go too far on the shot calling thing. Because from what I know, I do get the sense that Yellow Star's a fantastic shot caller, extremely high in-game IQ. But here's one of my problems with that whole thing of like, this guy's the shot caller and here's what I think about his shot calling. How many of you fuckers know what the Koreans and Chinese players sound like shot calling? Oh, none. You never heard it. Of course you haven't. None of us know. So unfortunately, you can sort of give credit there, but at the same time, I'm not exaggerating. I bet you I could, if we got together some writers, people even who we respect, I bet I could trick some of them into thinking that like a certain player is the shot caller for Chinese team and they get it wrong.
I do know usually who the shot callers on the teams are, either because I've watched them practice or because I actually have active.
But I bet I could trick some people. I bet I could get them off and they'd think this guy was and it wasn't. And
sure.
So unfortunately, what I'm saying on that one is, we don't really have the full picture on a lot of the Asian teams, unfortunately. So it's harder to make that judgment of who even is the best. Hence why, unfortunately, that storyline of Hai being the god-tier shot caller maybe does get a bit hammered a bit too much, as much as it's valid to a degree. So with that said, I'm actually not putting Yellow Star here just because he's this wonderful shot caller who's taken all these rookies and took them to the top line, which he has done all that shit. I'm actually putting him here because the great thing I think about Yellowstar is it to really appreciate Yellowstar, you do have to go back to the fact that he wasn't a fucking support player. He was an AD carry. Yep. And he wasn't even some... I don't care what anyone says. He wasn't some beast AD carry. He's just an AD carry. Yeah, he did shot calling in that position as well. But when he switched to support, it's like that concept that when you're of the beginner's mind, where actually, when you start to learn something, you're most susceptible to be able to learn advanced concepts. That actually a guy who's entrenched in it and who says, like, is an 8 out of 10 level proficiency, he might actually be hindered in some sense from learning to get to a 9 out of 10 because he thinks he knows it all. He thinks he has an idea of how to play it. And you see this in League of Legends. You see great players who don't adapt to the next season because they still think, no, I can make it work my way. I can make my champions work. I can make this approach works. Yellowstar seems to me one of the most malleable players I've ever seen in League of Legends. He can play with any player. He can play with any style of team almost. He can play in any meta. He can play with any, just almost anything against any opponent.
And he proved it considering that we saw Soaz and Xpeke leave. And especially in the spring season, he just had all their teammates.
I mean, the Steelback one especially. Listen, I used to sort of slightly deride Reckless in the spring split and summer split of 2014 because I always used to say the dude lanes with Yellowstar, that guy's gonna ensure you look good. You're at the very worst, you're gonna be okay and everything's gonna be fucking awesome. So for me, unfortunately, this will sound like a bag on Reckless, but just look what he did with Steelback, mate. He didn't miss a beat. He went from Reckless to Steelback back to Reckless, and the guy didn't miss a beat. And Steelback, who the fuck is Steelback now? All you people who thought he was great, where is he? He will never be on a top team for the rest of his life. It will never happen. And that's not a diss to him. That's just who he is as a player. Somehow, he locked into the best job you could ever get as an AD carry, laning with fucking Yellowstar, who knows when to be there, when to fuck off and let you on your own. Yellowstar's the ultimate Western player at just going around the map wherever you need to go as a support player. He's just the best. I think he's the best at doing that over any of the others. So I don't think he's like the best lane support or whatever. He is good at that stuff, but just the versatility, all-round game is insane from Yellowstar, I think.
I agree. I mean, I think he's very good. I have him, like I said.
18, I think you said.
18, yeah.
So, okay. Number 15 is where Thorin said he had Marin. So who's 15 for you?
You're going to enjoy this one, too. I have Bang.
Jesus, I think it goes without saying, Manny. He didn't make my list. It didn't make the list.
I don't think he did. But I also think that you don't look at Bang in the right way. So first off, Bang is actually much more flexible than people give him credit for. And a lot of SK Telecom's games, especially from the summer season, where EasyHoon was playing, Bang was actually put on Vayne in almost every one of those games, and he was expected to actually carry the team, and he did. I will say that obviously his carrying performance is much less consistent than that of Imp or Deft, but Bang is he doesn't have the same highs or the same, but he's very consistent at what he does, and he's very smart about how he plays the map. He almost never dies or makes mistakes, and sometimes he just has a game where he goes off. He's also professionally undefeated on Kalista still, so he doesn't lose on that champion, and he's actually shown more depth, and he's shown progressively over summer with SK Telecom's sort of movement to playing Vayne that he's actually very capable of playing some of these hyper carries, both with and without Faker. So I think he's actually pretty underrated by a lot of people.
Here's my problem, Monty. On Monty's list, Bang plays with the number one and number 10 player on the list.
Yes. True.
I mean, I don't think you'd describe SKT like you just did LGD, like they went off individual skill and they just rolled it. It's a team approach, right? And the absolute best player of all time.
Yes. Which is why they're lower than the LGD players. Okay. It doesn't mean that they have bad players, though.
No, I'm not saying they're bad, but I'm just saying that, listen, I can already tell this last five is going to be like a fist fight in a phone booth, mate. It's going to go, all shit's going to go out the window completely. So remember, I had Marin there. Yep. Okay, so number 16, it's already going to start to get sexy as fuck right now, Monty. What do you have number 16, mate?
Yes.
Give me one clue then.
You're not going to like it.
I'm not going to like it. Right, well, let me think who could it be then. Let me think what team it could be from. Is it an Asian player?
Yes.
Okay, if it's an Asian player, then I think it's going to have to be someone like, let me see. So we already did all of LGD, right? So SKT, is it Bengi?
It's Bengi.
Jump off a fucking cliff. I got to it straight away, Monty. I got to it straight away. How did I do it? I know you, mate. I know you inside and out.
Yeah, you did.
All I needed to know was it's an Asian player and it's someone I'm not going to like. So there we go. We're in there already. It's Bengi. Okay, go then, mate. Tell me why Bengi's on this list.
This is the last jungler that I have. So I only have three junglers on this list.
Okay. And you only get three junglers, Monty. They're like strikes. You get three and then it's done.
So Bengi actually has had an extremely good season. I was a little like split as to whether Bang or Bengi should be, which order they should be in. But Bengi has really picked it up. His jungle pathing is among the best in the world. He applied a ton of pressure. His finals performance, in my mind, Bengi deserves MVP for the finals against KT. He played absolutely amazingly. And of course, Faker had some amazing plays on Riven, but if it wasn't for Bengi actively diving someday or trying to keep Peekaboo in lane and shutting down KT's strengths, I don't know if SKT wins that match that dominantly. He altered a lot of his play and was playing a much more dive-oriented style. His mechanics in the finals were super good. His skill shot accuracy has been very good at the end of the season. He has been a major force for SK Telecom in the summer season. He's one of the smartest junglers out there and most reliable. And his mechanics have been looking good. And Bengi is a player that has like 3 month periods of being either mechanically very good or kind of a dumpster. And we've seen both sides of him throughout his career, but he's definitely at a very high point right now. So I think Bengi is underrated by a lot of people at the moment.
When you say he could have been the MVP, I have a problem with that, because my problem with that is, okay, I'll just tell you outright, I hate MVP voting, where what people do is they figure out like, okay, this factor I expected, this one was slightly different, therefore that's the deciding factor. Okay, in that context it is, but I don't know anyone who could have done what Faker did in that final. It was unreal.
But
Game 2 and Game 3 were bananas.
He was able to do that because Faker was able to play that aggressively under turrets because of what Bengi was doing.
Listen, I'm not denying something to do with it, but that's the problem with that, Monty, is even if you give me, like, I mean, obviously this isn't how baseball works, but let's say you give me the perfect speed and threat of pass, you pass me the ball, if I smash it 600 meters out of the park, you can't be like, I kind of did that, so you know, I gave you that pass, right? I mean, it was me who gave you that. If I didn't give you exactly right, you maybe only hit 400 meters, you know, whatever it is. Like, sure. It's pretty hard to hit the 600. That's kind of the key part to me. Obviously, Bengi, we can differ on that.
Bengi did so much in that series. He did so much work in that series. And a lot of it was just dumb shit that most people don't notice, like standing in a brush for a counter gank at the right time or being able to read KT's style. But
so here's another factor.
And he helped Marin so much in that final with the dives.
Here's a problem, Monty. He's a jungler who plays with three other people you have on your list.
Sure.
And that will be noted because of what I'm about to tell you, Monty. So remember how Marin gets to play Maokai all day, all night. It's Maokai, Maokai, Maokai. It's even worse for Bengi, mate. This guy will pick two champions and he just gets him every game. I mean, he had summer split. It was just Evelynn, Rek'Sai all day long. Spring split, Jarvan 24/7. In the playoffs, in the final, you know that great final? He only played Elise. They never banned it ever.
Yep. That's true.
Really god. Like, think about fucking Rush. He can't even get on his main two champions in half the games.
Yes, it's true. And he definitely benefits a lot from having Faker on his team, just like Marin does. There's a reason why he's 16 and Faker is number one.
Okay. Well, no, you've literally got it exactly right there, mate. You've even said it like that. There's a reason why he's number 16, but I just removed the middle part. It's like, because Faker is number one. See what I did there? Okay, keep going anyway.
So, yes, and I do think that, interestingly, we also know that he's very good at Lee Sin, but he wasn't playing it at all. So that's another factor to consider, is that he can definitely add this particular champion.
Must be a nice luxury to have champions you're wicked at. You never even have to bring out on competitive, you know. It'd be nice to be able to live in that world, wouldn't it?
Wouldn't be great, right?
I mean, that's what we don't know, is that he did love in a dumpster, but then it's actually like it was over a manhole, which led to an underground luxury villa suite underneath, which Faker furnishes for him and allows him to live for in exchange for being the best goddamn butler you ever saw.
That's true. Do you have any more than two junglers on your list?
No, I only have Clearlove and Cacao.
Interesting. Okay.
Because unfortunately, like I said, like first of all, top lane is not only, I think, the strongest meta-wise, but I also think at the moment it just has an incredible crop because a lot of the new wave of top laners have been amazing this year. And then secondly, I think jungle's the one that Korean moves wrecked completely. And sadly, Korea wasn't able to really furnish too many junglers to replace the new blood. Because even the ones that were good, so okay, someone like Fixer, yeah, well, he's fucking stuck in some shitter team.
Chaser,
yeah, that's what I mean. Chaser's stuck in no man's land, so he can't even make an impact. Meanwhile, I mean, Score's like, yeah, he's good, but he's never going to be considered a star.
Sure, that's true.
Unless you now tell me, like, number 16, Score. Some shit like that, whatever.
Score.
Maybe that's what's coming next. I don't know, mate. We'll see. So, number... I haven't told you mine.
Yeah,
you ready? Let madness reign supreme, Monty. You ready? I am a lolesports writer. Number 16, Ziv.
Ooh. Ooh.
Oh, yeah.
I really struggle.
Oh, yeah.
Ziv is like 21 for me. Okay.
Okay.
So I think Ziv is great. Ziv was obviously the MVP of the LMS regular season. He's definitely a very good top laner. And so I, like I said, I had him as, if I had 21, he would have been the fifth top laner on my list. So it was really hard for me to decide to leave Ziv off this list. I may regret that. I think he is probably going to have a very good performance at Worlds. So why is Ziv up there for you?
Because the thing is, like, he is actually a player where... What's funny is the reason I started watching LMS, I didn't think I was going to watch much. I watched it at the end of their summer season when they were going into playoffs. And I went back and watched a bunch of the games. And all I was watching initially was Hong Kong esports games. Because I was actually doing it for my own curiosity to see how Toys was doing, to see if it gave me any different perspective on his career before. Just because I actually like, when I have a preconceived notion about a player, every now and then I try to purposely watch a few games additionally of him in a different circumstance to see if it changes it at all. Like, see whether I solidified a certain concept too much. So for example, I mean, someone once asked me about my method, and I told them when I'm first investigating a player, I'll literally go and look for score sites, like scoreboards, and I'll pick out, like, okay, let's say I pick out 5 carry games, like 3-on-1 champion, then I'll pick like 2 really bad games to see what's like at the absolute worst, then I'll have like 2 medium games, and I try to get like a spread. I try to use like a statistical approach, basically, where once you get if you get a reasonable enough spread, it can tell you more about a wider amount of the data that you can't look at right now. So yeah. I tried to do that with Hong Kong Esports, right? And as I was doing so, I started to watch the odd AHQ game, and I had a lot of the preconceptions a lot of people had, which was like, okay, I knew from talking to Clement that like the Westdoor distraction is kind of prevalent. So I naively at the time actually thought, oh, it's the AD carry Ann who's the really good player on that team, and he is definitely a good player. I was watching their games, and I would just find game after game where that Ziv guy was just a monster. He was like really, really sick.
His teleport play is super good.
And so he was a player where, I mean, I realize already the hypocrisy is going to be coming out by like Western fans, like, but he's not even in a good reason. Yes, tell me more about why Double Lift and Hooney are on your list again, sir. Because that's one of the points that I discovered in doing this, Monty. I really did discover that, no exaggeration, in terms of top teams, LMS right now is as good or better than EU and NA LCS. Yep. It's really good right now.
Yep.
The top 3 or 4 teams are dynamite. It's really good to watch, actually.
Yep.
And sadly, those bans kind of, unfortunately, handicapped the playoffs a bit. Otherwise, it was actually dynamite when I was watching. I was amazed by the level. Like, because the problem is, it's not like I've never watched it before. I remember going back in the old TPA days in 2013 and watching some of the GPL and all that.
Oh, yeah,
it was GPL fucking terrible. It was absolutely terrible. It was just like almost practice, you know. They were just dumpstering utter terrible players. It's nothing like that now. So anyway, yeah, he's a really skilled player, even in the context of his region not being as good as China and Korea. I mean, I really do think if this guy goes to China, he'll be good.
So, yes, I agree with you. And for me, it was hard to get my list down to 20 just because Ziv was on this list too. And it wasn't hard to get my list to 21. It was hard to get it to 20. So he was like right on the cusp there.
And I think actually he's a player where if I had to pick one player for this tournament who has the biggest potential to shock Western players, it's got to be Ziv, I think. He's the one player where, in theory, they know almost nothing about him, but I mean, admittedly, I think he has a good group for it. I think he can actually just go ham in this tournament. Like, put it this way, if he dumps this fucking Hooney, it's already going to be blowing, melting people's little... It's going to be twisting their melons, as Liam Gallagher would say, mate. Like, that's going to be some deep shit right there. So that would be amazing to me. I think that would be some crazy shit. So, okay, I have him there. I have him number 16. Okay, number 17, Monty, who do you have?
Do we talk about... No, we're at number 16, right?
Number 16 was Bengi, right?
Oh, Bengi, right. So yeah, 17, Bengi's we already if. Know, for me, was Peekaboo.
Ah, Peekaboo. Right, let me see. So here's where it's already getting contentious. I can tell by your list you don't have him on there. So actually, at number 7, I have Prey.
Really?
Now, admittedly, I've already started to veer into my own territory, which previously was my trap card for you, which is like, yes, Darren, you have Gorilla and Schmeb in your top 7. How is that possible? This Prey fellow sure has a lot of help, doesn't it? And I'm like, yes, Mirror Thorin, you have got me on that one. It's true. He does have really sick players. And I did, for each of them, use the logic that they play with shitters. Therefore, who is he? But I do feel like, okay, we all know Ku is at their best when they do like mid to late game team fights. And those, the beauty of how they team fight, sometimes it almost makes you think they're better than they are. They're not actually as good as they seem sometimes. But
the fact that they know which fights to take. That's the core thing about Ku, is they know when to fight to make them look better on item power spikes and stuff like that.
And when they do that, Prey just gets to look amazing. And well, I won't deny it. A lot of it's the aesthetic value of when he looks fucking awesome in some of these fights. But
okay,
I just think he's a really good player still.
Here's the thing about Prey. When they started out and they were Juggernaut, the Ku Tigers invented the Juggernaut composition. They were running it in the spring. Prey looked fucking great on that, right? His positioning was very good. But as they went into Summoner, Prey really didn't look good. And oftentimes his positioning mistakes in team fights would actually cost Ku games. So he's been kind of up and down, really. And that's my problem. The way he ended the season, Ku's playoff run, his positioning looked good again. But there were multiple times where they would, even the Ku Tigers would fail to run the Juggernaut properly because Prey wasn't positioned well.
Yeah, no, so, unfortunately he had summer. His issues so, like, towards the end.
So in parts of Summer, Prey, I think, was one of the biggest problems on Ku, which prevents me from putting him on this list, even though he ended up looking pretty good in playoffs.
So, I think, though, that he did fit the meta well in some of those. His Corki Sivir was on point.
Of course, he did fit the meta, but then we also have to consider the other factor is that a lot of times he was picking losing matchups and not doing very well in lane. When playoffs rolled around, or towards the end of the season, when he started playing a lot more picks such as like Lucian, that really helped out quite a bit. So that's another thing to consider, is that he ended the season playing a lot of lane dominant champions, and I think we'll continue to see him play Lucian later on. He also played a lot of Ashe and turned out to be quite good on that pick. So
okay, let me see. That was number 17. Number 18, you had Yellow Star. We already went over that one.
Yes.
Here we go. I'll even tell you right now, it's a straight bias pick. But I could, listen, unlike some of the other people who have bias picks, you know, Monty, bias picks are my strong suit, mate. That's what I thought so much about. I could go for days. I could give you subcategories. I could push you to the other criteria. I could keep it going for days. And I win by endurance in those ones, okay? So number 18, Soaz.
Soaz. I knew there it. We go. I knew it was fucking Soaz.
There we go. I've been waiting so long for a meta to come around that would fit this guy. Because in the past, what made him brilliant was always that he had a few meta picks, but it was always the outside meta picks that he was so good at. Now he's actually going to be a beast on the meta picks. So Jesus, this is actually the dream time to watch Soaz play. And the thing is, he's one of the only players I can forgive where he does do that shit. Where I say, I don't want to practice.
Dies randomly. And he dies randomly too, dude.
Yeah, sure. But he is so brilliant as a Western player. Yes. I think he's just fucking phenomenal player. He's just something. He's got a very unique quality for a Western player, I think.
he was so good, right, in the finals for EU on that gangplank. But at the same time, his lack of map awareness is what sort of holds him back for me. Sometimes his teleports aren't that great. Sometimes he just randomly dies while split pushing, and or he's in the wrong position to start a team fight. So on an individual level, Soaz is very flashy. We see what he can do with the GP. But when it comes to coordinating with his team, that's where Soaz can't be on the list, the top 20 for me. I have Febiven, by the way.
Okay. So why is Febiven in the top 20 players?
He's really developed as a player, I feel, over the course of the summer season to have a lot more versatility in terms of his play styles. He's still going to be very dangerous on a lot of the assassin picks that are going to be coming back, I think, for the World Championship. And he really helps out carrying that team. So I think Febiven is very good.
So that was number 19, yeah?
Yep.
Okay, the thing is, as I've mentioned already, everyone knows, after Korean top laners, Thorin's favorite position, yeah, we all know, EU mid laner, love him, love you, want more of you. Okay, great, love that position. Told you, it's always the, here's what's weird, it's obviously not in any way underrated as a position because it's the most famous regional position in the whole world. But what is underrated, and I think people really haven't thought about this enough, is you almost never see the top EU mid laners get dumpstered in competition. It just doesn't happen. It doesn't, even when they face the really good Koreans. Somehow, the way they're used within the regions means that when they play and match up, it's actually always really competitive. It's always a fun, that's, to me, that's always the most fun Western player against Korean player matchup, is I want to see the mid laners go against each other. Yeah. I mean, we know Xpeke has inexplicably done well against some of the Korean mids at times when he wasn't even supposed to be at his peak anymore.
Yeah, like last Worlds.
Yeah. I mean, put it this way, it's interesting that, isn't it, Monty? I don't, all the people who say Pawn is better than Faker on the basis that Pawn beat Faker, I don't see anyone saying that Xpeke is an all-time greater player than Dade, yet Dade literally lives in Xpeke's back pocket when they're in international tournaments. You know how in prison people have that like strict hierarchy. When they're in prison, Pawn literally just whips out like a red handkerchief or something and puts out his back pocket, so that's following Xpeke around. I don't even know if I've got the terminology right there. I think I saw something like that once in a TV show, and I might have just got it totally wrong.
Show, right?
Yeah. TV show. Anyway, so that's where I get all my information, Monty. Much like for scoring, I was just raised by watching a TV of American culture. Like, this is life. This is exactly like reality. And everyone was like, it's nothing like it, mate. I was like, shut up. It's better. Anyway, my number 19, this might just end the world, mate. No, actually, number 20 will end the world. So number 19 will just, it's a prelude to the apocalypse. Number 19, Thorin goes full hipster. I'm picking Maple. From the Flash.
Wait. No, we were on 20, right?
No, number 19. I didn't tell you. Yeah, but I didn't tell you my number 19.
You said Soaz.
No, Soaz is 18.
Oh, Soaz is 18, okay.
Yeah. No, Maple is my number 19, mate.
Okay.
Bold. Pretty bold, right?
Yeah. Maple isn't even the best fucking player on his team, dude. Karsa is.
I don't know about that, mate.
Listen,
you will see. Worlds this year, you will see. When Flash Wolves get out of Group A, Monty, which they will, even with Stake on his back, Maple, who is the truth, the way, the light, he will show you what it's all about, mate. He's a good player. He's underrated. He can match up with anyone. He's a good player, mate.
I don't even think he is the best player on his team. I think Karsa is the best player on the Flash Wolves.
Debatable, but junglers don't get on my list, as I've already shown you. Fuck junglers. So he didn't gank for Flame during 2014, so fuck them. They're done. I'm done with the junglers, okay? I waited till I had a chance, like Game of Thrones, and I had them banished.
Not only that, but you understood that junglers can't get in that ass, so...
Exactly. I was so disappointed. I kept waiting for all those all-time great junglers to get in that ass, and then none of them, they all refused to, in fact, inhabit that ass. And they're just like, no, I think I'll just play jungle and kill buffs and stuff. I'm like, you fucking... In fact, I'll give you the example. Here's my problem with junglers. My problem with junglers is, of all the times it would have made sense to me for Kakao to go back in time to like a super low econ style of jungling, instead, he had so many games where he tried to farm up and it didn't always work out. And I was so underwhelming because I kept thinking like, dude, look at some of the people you're playing against as the other jungler. You could just bully this guy. What are you doing farming now? I can only assume that some coach like, Kakao, yes sir, this is how jungle's played now, like yes master, like I can't even believe that shit. You know what, Monty, I once saw a documentary about North Korea And it made this really incredible point about North Korea that I'd never considered before. So, you know, one of the naive things Westerners will say about North Koreans is that stupid logic of like, well, I don't know why they don't just rebel and just like fight against it and stuff. Like, when this guy went into North Korea, he was going around and he looked at like some of the areas, like the hotels he was in, and he noticed that at no point in time had he heard any music being played. And what he did was he went around, and the closest he could get was in Korea. Basically, all Western music is banned in North Korea, and all you're allowed to listen to on the radio is government-issued music, which is about like Kim Jong-il, you know, all that sort of ridiculous shit, which is built into the mythology and almost like religious fervor of their country. So what this guy realized, which is like an incredible paradigm breaker if you think about it, is a North Korean person, in theory, has never heard rock and roll music. Like, you know how much of that is ingrained with all youth and anti-authoritarian stuff? Now, it's not entirely true. Apparently, a Korean girl I just happened to know for the purposes of researching this told me that, yeah, people smuggle stuff in and it's like a black market item, etc.
Yeah.
But as a result, in general, it hasn't permeated their culture to the same degree. So whenever you think of Westerners and when people go through a rebellious phase and when they're learning about politics and stuff, it all comes from music. It always tends to come from, like, they're into Bob Dylan or the Rolling Stones or the, well, who else would it be? Like, yeah, any of these sorts of bands, the Pistols, all these sorts of, these inhabit that sort of youthful vibe. So since they don't have that, they've never really encountered that sort of like paradigm breaking quality. Okay. So I feel like it's like that in terms of these junglers in that particular sense. Where was I going with this one?
I have no idea.
Let me think. Where did I originally start to go with that? I lost the point on the jungler part. I got so deep on the Korean part. That's what I lost. Let me think. Oh, that's right. I know what it is. Here's what I would do, Monty. If I ever... You're lucky I haven't learned Korean, mate, and that I haven't tried to get into the Korean scene. Because if I did, I would be like some little North Korean who's within this little commune, okay? Somehow, someone smuggles in. It's not just going to be anything, mate. It's not going to be like Elvis Presley or the Rolling Stones or something like that, right? Someone smuggles in that first Oasis album. Definitely, maybe. And it's so raw, and the swagger and the attitude. And it's just in your face, and I'm the best, and fuck you and your band shit, and my band's the best, and we're taking drugs, and it's rock and roll. And we don't give a fuck about you. And we're going to rule the world. We're the best band in the world. That's what me getting into the Korean underbelly would be like, Monty. I would become the diseased prion of mad cow disease that takes over the brain and destroys it from internally, utterly. And you don't notice until that cow is stumbling over on its feeble legs, falling to the floor.
I don't even know why this metaphor exists. What do you get?
Here's how it goes, okay? Because I would go to players like Kakao, and I'd go, you do realize your coach knows nothing about jungle position, right? You'd be like, what do you mean? I'd be like, you know better than him on all us. You are a god. You know that scene, Monty, in X-Men 2, where the young X-Men Pyro is in that ship when they're going to rescue all the X-Men, where the Professor X and all those have been taken off that compound by Stryker, who was Wolverine's old military sergeant or whatever. And what happens is, the people who are left, Wolverine and I think it's Storm, have to team up with Magneto and his like evil mutants, and they're going to go and because they're going to fight a common good. So when they're sat waiting for this to meet up, okay, Magneto says to Pyro, like, you know, you are a god among ants. Like, don't ever let anyone tell you otherwise. Because he's like, oh, I can only make like fire. Like, I can't make the fire. You can only like, mold it or whatever. And he just tells him, like, you're a god among ants compared to humans, okay? That's what my effect would be like on the Koreans, okay? And I would just spread so much defense. You'd have 15 psoriasis after that, mate. You'd have 12 forgivens. I would just run around. I'd destroy the entire Korea. The government would literally have to deport me at that point.
I think that already happened, Thorin. It was called the Korean players going to the LPL.
It's true.
I'm pretty sure we already saw that occur.
But I actually think, bearing in mind the things you told me on Twitter, that actually the Korean government might just deport me if that ever happened. That's the reason I haven't done it so far, because it's so important. I can't be cut off, Monty, from my life-sustaining supply of Korean pizza. Little throwback for the show there. So anyway, we've done. That's number 19. Last one, Monty. What is number 20 for you? So I just stacked like 7 metaphors. I thought we did. I had almost nothing to do with the original point.
I don't know where you went with that. So.
Number 20.
Anyway, with mine, I actually agree with lolesports. I have double lift.
Oh my god! Do you know what, Monty? I have double lift number 20.
Oh there shit!
We agree with lolesports, both of us.
I actually thought that was a good call by lolesports because double lift had such a good summer season. I mean, statistically, he nearly never died even when they lost. He was hard carrying the shit out of them. He performed well in the clutch and playoffs. He played really, really well.
He's also an example of where the whole thing I said before about when you were giving MVP to Bengi, what that kind of alludes to is a mindset that I really hate, which is in teams, it even happens in pro sports, people tend to have a really linear style of thinking. So say a player joins a team and then the record gets way better. They always say, right, it was that player. He was the MVP. Well, sometimes maybe the MVP was waiting there, but he didn't have the piece to facilitate him being the MVP.
Sure.
So I think Dubliff's a great example of that. Say what you want about Zion Spartan. Say what you want about Pobel. Afremu's very, very, very capable player who's a very good Western support player. But for me, Dubliff's the engine of that team. No one else probably in NA could do that. And he was just activated by those players. He was always latent to a degree. I mean, part of it, yes, his attitude and all that stuff, but he just didn't have the right pieces around him at the right time. And now that he did, guess what? Instantly the switch was flipped, and then now he's just an awesome player. And yeah, he's not fucking Imp, is he? But he's still a really good player.
Absolutely. And I think that Afremu's improvement, and particularly one thing that you like to write Afremu for, is that he choked in the playoffs and he never was that player. And it looks like whatever coaching that CLG done or Afremu's own growth as a player, who the fuck knows what the cause was, but he definitely played very well in the playoffs, right? That's what one thing we can say that changed a lot about Afremu, which I think may have caused, I think Afremu would probably be in my 20 to 30 list, I would guess, but he's not in my top 20. And I think that certainly helped bolster Dubliff's performance later in the game.
And here's the big problem, okay, is that when you're talking about Afremu, he did definitely turn that around, and that was an issue he'd had before, but the competition is so weak in NA at his position, I think.
Especially with
not having a really great playoff run
or something like that.
That also kind of is what's disappointing. I mean, they wouldn't have played anyway unless they made the final, but
sure.
It's like there was one guy always stood in his way the whole time, and then rather than have to actually meet that guy and beat him, that guy, he just, a telegram came, he died in his sleep. Like, what the fuck? I just finished the Kung Fu training. I'm at the top floor of the dojo. Like, yeah, that master, he had like a really bad curry. It wrecked him, mate. His intestines are everywhere. Like, he's dead. He's like, what? If they just hand you the crown, it doesn't feel as good, does it? You have to wrench it from the old king's dead head and then kick his head out the way. You can't quite pull it off. So you pull it and then you kick him in the back of his head and it goes off.
All right.
That's how you want to take the crown.
Calm down there, Macbeth.
Okay, so here's the thing. Hey, listen, mate, my name's Duncan, so if anything, I wouldn't like that, mate. So, yeah. So here's the question. Let's name a couple of names who didn't make your list but tortured you.
So Ziv.
Who would they be? He's one?
Ziv, Soez, for me too. Ziv, Soez, Karsa.
Because the main ones for me, I had three, really. Which
Pawn.
Was Pawn, Febiven, and PYL. But I have, okay. I mean, I've given, if you notice, they're all in a similar position. I've already got like two elite players from their teams. Yeah, it's the same sort of factor I'm using there. There was one more that I didn't have, just because there's a lot of factors that don't.
Of course, Hooney for me too. I didn't have Hooney. So those are the big ones.
So one that there's a lot of factors that meant that it just isn't relevant to put him on is Koro 1. Because unfortunately, this whole thing where he wasn't always playing in the summer split, and now it doesn't like he's playing at all. I think Koro 1, sadly, he had the wrong time to have a peak in his career, because people only remember Worlds, sadly, in the end of the year. As an aficionado of the top lane, what that guy did in the spring season was unreal. I mean, his performance at MSI was bananas. If you ever want to see a sick series, go watch the one that no one remembers, the semi-final of AHQ at EDG.
Yep.
He goes fucking god mode. He's like killing people, like 10 kills, 15 assists.
He didn't have the best performance in the finals against Marin, though. Like, Marin kind of dominated him a couple times. It wasn't as clear-cut. I mean, Koro still did well in some of the games in the finals, but it wasn't like him just stomping all over like what happened with against EDG and HQ.
And that was literally a utility top who showed no signs that he was going to be a super-duper carry and really just snapped into that mode and was ridiculous on one of the best teams. So, yeah, he's a big one for me.
Right, and unfortunately, Koro just didn't replicate that success in the summer season. Like, he looked shaky at times, and then, like, Amazing J was in there, and then, you know, they lost in the actual playoffs using Koro 1 and then came back with Amazing J in 1. So it's hard to put him in the top 20 right now because of what happened in summer.
Okay. So Monty, we're nearing the end now, and let me think. Did the while we were talking, without messing anything up, did the call ever die at any point during the show? I don't think it did, right? I think we kept going the whole way.
No, we
so, okay. I don't want to have to edit, Monty, so don't say anything crazy shit at the end. We're just going to have to try and end so I can click the button and that file can just go up in one piece. So do you have any final thoughts at the end of this episode of Summon Insight, Monty?
I do. You know, going back to your position on junglers and being that insidious force, I think you need to start your own campaign for jungle buggery and sodomy so that you can actually finally we can see these jungle players getting in that ass. So Thorin for buggery and sodomy 2016.
I mean, basically what diamond procs used to do to people in season 2. I mean, I understand why Dandy didn't do that often, because he didn't need to. He could just gank all the time, a counter gank, and his team's gonna wreck anyway because he's ever got monster laners. But Kakao used to do that in 2014. He used to just fuck the other guy up so much. It was like, you knew which teams were going to get wrecked by him. They had no chance, you know. So it's just kind of sad to me that there's not really that many candidates left who can do that. I mean, you take one that could, Rush, who's this phenomenal. He's like an otherworldly solo queue talent. And then you put him on a team where you gradually take away pieces that could in any way facilitate doing that. And then he gets two bans at him every game. Like, what kind of nightmare's that? So yeah, there's no one doing it, mate. There's no one doing that role for me. Essentially, there's no one who is the me of the Korean scene, the definitely maybe Oasis album infiltration that fucks up everything from the inside. That's what I'm looking for in this scene. Oh yeah, there was one other thing. I think there was one more thing. Let me think what it was. Oh, Monty, I can't forget this. Did you watch that part of TSM Legends?
No.
You're in for a treat.
I never watched that garbage.
Watch the last 5 minutes, because in the last 5 minutes, okay, they have the live Worlds group draw, and they have Monty and Reggie. They're the only ones.
Monty?
little Freudian slip there, mate. Oh, it was Monty and Reggie. It wasn't Loco and Monty. It was Monty and Reggie, person.
Why do I have to be Loco? So,
by the way, Monty, another thing. The 10 years up, he only got a year, remember, of being called Lord. That ended. He's just Loco Loco now. The sick shitter coach of TSM. So he's back to being that.
Far.
We all said it. So
no.
So say we all. And no, here's the thing. So it's just him and Reggie sat on a couch watching the World's group draw. And it gets to the point, Monty, where they've drawn all the Pool 1 teams. They've drawn the first line of Pool 2 teams. And then they get to, like, I think the order was that they got to... Okay, they were drawn the next one, but obviously TSM couldn't be in Group A because Group A has already gotten CLG.
They had CLG, Flash Wars. So that's it.
So CLG, they can't be in that group.
Yeah,
okay.
They can't be in that group.
Group B, they're hoping, right? Hope we get in Group B, because remember, Group B was Fnatic, IG, and hopefully it does, right? That's not a bad draw. That's a good doing. You know, play Fnatic or something. No, Group B gets AHQ. So now they're thinking it's got to be Group C, please, Group C. Because in Group C, I wonder if I'm remembering this right. Yeah, Group C is the one that has SKT, H2K. That's not so bad if we get that one. Hey, maybe we can live that. H2K, we can beat them. They're hoping that, right? And Group B, Z is obviously already LGD, KT, we do not, come on, we can't have Group D. That's what they're saying to each other, okay?
Right.
And they're all waiting. And here's what's better. Don't spoil it, Monty. So someone just says from the background, we need them to pick us out now. And Loco's like, yeah, we need them to pick us out now so we can go in Group C. We don't want to be in Group D. And Froggen picks out TSM. So here's what's great, Monty. On the cast, they start explaining what can happen at that point and the extra context. So they don't know this because they're too busy. They put the laptop down. They're jumping around, celebrating, going, yeah, oh my God, we got the second best one. Yeah. And then all of a sudden, you won't believe it, Monty. It's like it was scripted, because as they're celebrating, they look, and on the screen, instead of going into Group C, it pops into Group D. And suddenly they just look at the camera like, what? And then Reggie's just got this look at his beautiful man. He's got this look on his face, like confusion, like, what is happening, Loco?
Because
Loco
says,
like, yep.
The only reason that could happen is because EDG was the last team to draw, and EDG couldn't draw into Group D because LGD was already there.
No, it was Ku Tigers. Ku Tigers hadn't been drawn yet into Group C.
No, Group A. Group A is Ku Tigers, dude.
Let me think.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the point is they couldn't go into Group D.
Anyway.
They couldn't go into Group D as well, though, because KT was there already. So the point is, what they didn't know, here's the genius of it, Monty, is that before they even started celebrating, if they'd actually figured it out, they were already in Group D.
Yep.
So essentially, they celebrated after they were already definitely in Group D. They were never going anywhere else. And as a result, it's the most genius little turnaround Schadenfreude moment. It's so good. Monty, it felt so good inside. It made me just feel so, so good to be alive. That I can have this little bit of context in that moment to just replay over and over again. It was fucking amazing, mate. It was the choreographed bit where they were dancing and then suddenly they waited for the TSM logo to appear in Group C and it just sort of went like, burr, burr, and just appeared in Group D. It was amazing. I can't even relay. And not only that, Monty, then Loco said, what are the immortal lines? He goes, we could still get Origin too. And they obviously did. Oh my God, it was so good. It was so good, mate. You can't even, because obviously the universe could have given him a break and just given him like Bangkok Titans there, but no, they get Origin as well. Fuck you. So, okay, yeah. So I think that's about it, Monty. I just had to let you in on my experience there. So you've got that to look forward to. So go, maybe get a fine whiskey, have a cigar on hand, have a little bit of hors d'oeuvres beforehand. Nothing too big because you want to save room for the main meal, Monty, feasting on human suffering of someone who was formerly a lord but is now just a normal human being again. Hey, I gave him a step up there. I said he was a normal human being. So he's just a normal human being now. So I think that's the end of the show, right, Monty?
It is.
Thanks to Alpha Draft and pressing stop.